Welcome to the second meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Could I first of all remind everyone present to please turn off any mobile phones or other electronic devices. As members will be aware, Richard Baker has resigned as an MSP on Monday. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Richard for his contribution to the Finance Committee and wish him every success in the future. So we are therefore down to six members of the committee, at least for today. Our first item of business is to take evidence in relation to the recent UK spending review from Paul Johnson, Director of the Institute of Fiscal Studies. I'd like to welcome Mr. Johnson to the meeting and invite him to make an opening statement. Paul?
Thank you very much. Just a couple of points to make, I think, as part of the opening statement. As the as will have been clear following the spending review, the scale of the cuts being imposed was somewhat less, well, significantly less actually, than was implied by the manifesto of the Conservative Party last May, and a bit less than looked likely following the budget last July. And in particular, that meant that the scale of the cuts imposed on the so-called unprotected departments was somewhat less than we expected beforehand, but nevertheless significant. So the average cuts for unprotected departments over the next 5 years is still in the order of 17 or 18%. The pre-spending review figures suggested it might be as much as a quarter or even a little bit more. So one of the questions is why that change, first of all, since the manifesto, and secondly, since the July budget. Well, since the manifesto, there has simply been policy change. There has been a decision to delay some of the cuts, and there have been decisions to increase taxes by around £15 billion if you put the July budget and the autumn statement together. Secondly, and this is very much secondary, there were some forecasting changes from the Office of Budget Responsibility, which gave the Chancellor some additional room for manoeuvre. I think the third point I'd make is that the reason that actually some relatively small changes made quite a big change to the scale of the implied cuts for the unprotected departments is that there's a very big gearing effect, in the sense that the unprotected departments are becoming a smaller and smaller fraction of the total. So relatively small amounts of additional money can make quite big percentage differences. But I would stress that the scale of the changes are still, scale of the cuts both over the next 4 years and over the period since 2010 are still very substantial indeed. I think the second thing to say is that obviously all of this has been bookended by the fiscal charter. So there's a very clear rule that the Chancellor wants to work to, which is to get into surplus by 2019-20. And he continued to be aiming at a surplus of around £10 billion by that date. And as I say, it was in part some of the small forecasting changes that allowed him a little bit more flexibility than he might have expected. I think one of the big open questions about the next 2 or 3 years is how he will respond if forecasting changes move in the wrong direction, because this the fiscal target he's following through this parliament is extremely different from the fiscal target he was following through the last parliament. In the last parliament, if forecasts changed, if the economy was doing a little bit less well than expected, he could push his point of reaching budget balance out. His current rule does not allow that. And as the Office of Budget Responsibility have said, there's about a 45% chance that he won't meet that fiscal target because of the way that forecasts tend to change. So the big unanswered question following the spending review is what happens if forecasts change only actually quite modestly over a 3 or 4 year period. £10 billion 3 years out is a tiny number. I mean, £10 billion is a lot of money, but out of £700 or £800 billion of spending and taxes, it's a small change, and changes much bigger than that will happen in one direction or the other. So I think that leaves quite a bit of uncertainty around how they'll respond, whether that will be either on the tax side or the spending side. I think the third thing I'd say is that obviously a significant part of the spending review announcements was to partially undo the welfare changes that were announced in the July budget. I think the crucial thing to note there is that was undoing the changes to tax credits which were announced for this April onwards, but to make no change at all to the long-run structure of the universal credit benefit, which was cut back in the July budget. So that has two effects. That will protect everybody in cash terms. There'll be no losers this April, and indeed in the long run, anyone who is currently on tax credits will be protected. But all those moving on to universal credit afresh or moving off tax credits and then after a period moving on will get less than they otherwise would have done. So he's managed to save as much money as he was hoping in the long run, but without hitting people in cash terms in the short run. Of course, a concomitant of that was, and maybe this is something tells us something about how he might treat his fiscal charter, the concomitant of that was that he has abandoned essentially the welfare cap that he put in place just a year ago. That will be broken each of the next 3 or 4 years, and then only met by a whisker, and even then with some interesting accountancy by the end of the parliament. Of course, there's a whole set of other things that were going on in there, but I think those are the three points I'd make as the big headlines, as it were, from what we found after the spending review.
Thank you very much for that, Paul. That's greatly appreciated. I mean, we have both had copies of your statement from the 26th of November, and of course preceding that also the outlook for the 2015 spending review, so we'll be asking some questions based on that and indeed what you've just said just now. I mean, in terms of looking at the outlook, one of the things I found interesting was the section on the total departmental spending envelope, and obviously you talk about departmental expenditure limits and annual managed expenditure, and what you say basically is that annual managed expenditure will grow by 4.1% in real terms between 2015-16 and 19-20, but departmental expenditure limits will need to be cut back by 3.2% over this period to keep to government's total spending plans. Now, I'm not so much concerned about the specific percentages because obviously things have changed a wee bit since the review itself, but the general trend seems obviously towards AME rather than DEL. What does this mean for the stability of the public finances?
I mean, there's a couple of big things going on within the AME numbers. One is actually over time that we are, for working age welfare, actually seeing a significant reduction in the fraction of national income being devoted to that. And I can't remember the exact timing, but I think we're by the end of this parliament will be back to its lowest level for something like 30 years. So in terms of the AME numbers, the fraction of national income going to working age welfare is set to fall, and to fall quite significantly, certainly between the period between 2010 and 2020. So what's driving AME up are really two other things. One, of course, is pension age welfare, combination of an increasing number of people over pension age, and actually that number is increasing by 2 million over this decade. So we really are in a position where demographic change is having a significant effect actually right across the public finances. If you look at spending on social care, if you look at spending per capita across a range of things, if you look at spending on health, demographic change is having a big effect, but it's clearly having a big effect on the AME numbers. And in addition, the average pension entitlement among those hitting pension age is continuing to increase relative to the oldest pensioners. And secondly, of course, whilst interest rates are very low, debt is continuing to grow, and therefore the AME part of that bit of AME, which is debt interest spending, whilst not actually at historically high levels, is nevertheless growing as debt grows. Now, in terms of your question about whether that's what impact that has on the stability of the public finances, I think I'd say two things. One is that we are dependent more than we otherwise would be because of the stock of debt on what happens to interest rates going forward now, and indeed to inflation. So that bit of debt which is index linked, which is I can't remember, something like 200 or 300 billion, very much depends, the amount we have to pay depends on the rate of inflation, and if that goes up, then clearly we end up spending more. Now, as it's happened, over the last two or three fiscal events, inflation expectations have gone down, so that's given the Chancellor a windfall. That won't be true every time. That will happen in the opposite direction at some point going forward. And so that will create potentially challenges. The basic interest rate matters a bit less in a way because obviously the stock of debt isn't affected by the rate that you have to pay on new debt, but the debt nevertheless rolls over time. So as interest rates increase, then again that will have an effect on the public finances. Again, this is something which has been a positive shock over the last few fiscal events, but at some point will become a negative one. Into the longer term, clearly the increased spending or driven by an ageing population, it's not so much something which is going to create uncertainty in the public finances, because it's something we can foresee with considerable amount of certainty, but it will clearly create less space for other spending because of the changes that we're seeing.
Thanks for that. Now, you've said in your remarks from 26 November, talking about the Chancellor, saying he's going to need his luck to hold out. He set himself a completely inflexible fiscal target of a surplus in 2019-20. And you touched on that, obviously, in your opening statement. Now, obviously, since then, I mean, we've had the Chancellor say last week, and I quote, that we face a dangerous cocktail of economic threats. So there seems to be an indication that we're going to be heading in the wrong direction, even since the statement in November. And RBS yesterday predicted a 20% market fall and urged people to sell, which I thought wasn't... Well, I mean, one wonders, actually, about why they would do that. But anyway, so what you basically said if he's unlucky, and that's almost a 50-50 shot. Again, you talked about the OBR's prediction of a 55% likelihood of reaching the chance of reaching his target. How likely do you think that proportion is, just given what's been said in the last week or so? Plus changes in interest rates across the Atlantic. Sorry.
Well, clearly a lot of the recent news has been new and bad relative to what we knew even, what is it, less than 2 months ago since the autumn statement. My inclination is not to build too much on what is still a short period of additional news, but it is worth, you know, it is all bad. The stock market in this country has gone down. Clearly there are problems. Clearly there are problems in China. Actually, the most recent public finance numbers from the OBR are less positive than the ones that they knew about when they were making their forecasts for the at the autumn statement. So there are a set of things which are looking less positive than they did 2 months ago. I think it would, you know, where how big a difference that will make to the OBR's forecasts in March. I don't know, and they will have quite a difficult decision to decide whether this news which has come really quite recently is enough to make a significant change to their longer-term growth forecasts. If they do, and there wouldn't need to be very much in the way of a change, then that would make the fiscal rule much harder to meet. I mean, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but you wouldn't need to change growth forecast by more than a few tenths of a percentage point each year going forward to mean that on the current set of policies we wouldn't meet that that 10 billion surplus. And as I said at the beginning, that leaves, I think, a very difficult set of choices for the Chancellor. Does he, under those circumstances, decide actually he does need to cut spending on the police or local government or social services or whatever that he managed to protect back in the spending review, or does he need to find some additional taxes from somewhere else, or does he actually do something much more loose on his fiscal charter than he's currently intending, or does he just wait for something to turn up? I mean, one entirely plausible, I think, response would be to say, well, look, public finance...
See what happens eventually.
Exactly. Yeah. Public finance forecasts have changed in the last 3 months. it would be silly, wouldn't it, for me to make a big change in policy, given that we're seeing these things move around a lot. I'm not going to change policy at the moment, but if in a year's time they're still looking bad, then at that point I'll change policy. That would be something that he might decide to do.
Okay. Now, it's, in your outlook, you were predicting, you know, that in England, 64.3% was going to be the cut in local government grants over the entire decade. What's that likely to be now?
We've got a number for. I mean, I can't remember where that 64% number was, but essentially, local central government grants to local government, if you exclude that bit which is made up of business rates, will essentially fall to close to zero by the end of this parliament. So that's a remarkable change. Now, of course, that does not imply a reduction of anything like 64% in the spending capacity of local authorities. But this is part of a genuinely revolutionary change, I think, in the way that local government is financed. So you will have moved from a position in 2010 where effectively local government was financing about, I can't remember, it was a quarter or a third from council tax, and all of the rest was money that came essentially directly from central government. Now, a large chunk of that was business rates that was taken into central government and then redistributed, but to local government it just looked like 25 or 30% was coming from my council tax and the rest was just coming in a grant. By 2020, essentially 100% will be self-financed, about a third from the council tax and about two-thirds from business rates. And the difference being that business rates will now, all the business rate revenue will automatically go to local authorities, not in the sense that each one will keep all of its own business rates, but in two senses. First, that will be kept specifically within the local government, within local government, and secondly, any change within any local authority in the business rates revenue resulting from additional business and so on will be kept within that local authority. Now, actually, the level of expected business rates revenue by then suggests that, in fact, central government will give local government additional responsibilities, because the scale of the cuts from central government's point of view won't be big enough for local government. So to absorb, to create those additional real cuts, as it were, they'll, local authorities, we expect to be given additional responsibilities. Now, we didn't hear, I thought we might hear, but we didn't hear in the spending review what those additional responsibilities will be. That is something that we'll find out more about. I think the last thing I'd say on that is that we heard later in, sort of a week or two after the spending review, some more details about how central government grant to local authorities would be distributed, and actually the way that that happened changed somewhat. So as the period between 2010 and 2015, broadly speaking, the grant to each local authority fell much the same, so that those local authorities more dependent on grant suffered more in total. Now, that was changed somewhat in the December numbers, and the overall, you got something closer to a similar proportionate reduction in overall spending power rather than the same proportionate cut in central government grant. So that's more close to where we were pre-2010. So the period between 2010 and 2015 was significantly harder for those local authorities more dependent on central government grant. In other words, those which are broadly poorer, or in fact those in London, whereas the ones, the change in 2015 was more spread across in terms of spending power, spread across local authorities.
Yeah, the reason I ask about that is obviously because we've had evidence from our own committee that we should adopt a similar model in Scotland, so that's why it's of specific interest. One of the things you mentioned in your 26th November statement is about the £3 billion tax and payrolls of companies with pay bills over £3 million. I'm just wondering what impact that will have on those individual companies. Has there been any analysis on what that will the impact? I mean, there seemed to be a suggestion by the OBR that that might impact on the actual wages of the employees themselves.
And I think in the long run, I think that is the most likely effect. I mean, this is effectively a payroll tax, and therefore that will increase the cost to businesses of employing their staff, and you know, in the long run, one would generally expect that to result in a reduction in wages, just as we think that employer national insurance contributions are probably largely incident on the wages of the employees that they employ. I mean, the apprenticeship levy clearly has a second significant effect, which is that because you can offset it against anything that you might spend on apprenticeship training, it could have two of it. That essentially, up to the point at which your apprenticeship levy runs out, that means that the cost of apprenticeship training to you as a company is effectively zero, because you know, instead of paying £100 to the government, you pay £100 for your apprenticeship. So that could have two effects. That could result in a real increase in genuine new apprenticeship training, or it could result in some rebadging and relabeling of activities in a way which qualifies for that money, but actually doesn't change behaviour enormously in a real sense. And which of those predominates, I think we'll have to wait and see. It'll be nice to get some serious evaluation of the effect of that.
Thank you for that. Now, moving on to welfare, which again you touched on in your opening statement, you've said in your paper that in terms of disability benefit reforms, year after year expected savings from this reform go down. Why is that?
The DWP in their initial analysis, this is particularly of the movement from disability living allowance to the personal independence payment. They were expected this to be rolled out much quicker than it's actually turned out to be rolled out. And secondly, they expected much bigger savings following the rolling out of it on the basis of new medical tests. Now, neither of those predictions have proved robust, and indeed, each time a new prediction has been put in place, it's proved equally unrobust as the previous one. I think what they're finding is it's just much more difficult. First of all, it's much more difficult to do what they want to do from an administrative point of view. And secondly, actually, most of those who were benefiting from the disability living allowance were, quote, genuinely facing the kinds of disability that they were saying they were facing. Now, why did they get that so wrong? Well, I think, you know, you can understand, as it were, the reason for wanting to make this policy change. Spending on disability living allowance rose, and I don't have the numbers in my head, but rose really very fast in the period from the late 1990s through the 2000s. What I think happened there was that not in a way, in a sense, either that there was huge amounts of fraud or that the population got massively more disabled. It's just that the disability living allowance was as a new benefit introduced, I think, in the early 1990s. More and more people became aware that it was available, and as they became aware it was available, they claimed it. Actually moving back from that situation, unless you're going to significantly change what you're trying to achieve, and whilst personal independence payment does that to some extent, it is still looking to benefit largely the same group that the disability living allowance was intended to benefit. Actually, what we're finding is that there isn't that scale of opportunity to reduce spending that I think DWP thought there was.
Thank you. And sticking with welfare, I mean, I found it's quite fascinating if you said that if you thought the announced saving in 2016-17 was £4.44 billion, not £3.4 billion, you'd be right. The £4.4 billion number was just wrong. And then you have an interesting quote. You say the challenge of estimating interactions between HMRC tax credits and DWP benefits in the run-up to a fiscal event where the Treasury's policy costings process does not permit us to call on the expertise of officials across both departments and all measures that might be subject to interactions. I just wonder if you can talk us through this a wee bit, because it does seem interesting that the figures seem to be £1 billion out on that. I mean, £4.4 billion, it's quite a significant percentage difference.
The reason that I put that quote in there is that was a part of the process that I guess we hadn't been quite aware that there was that degree of constraint on the process that the OBR had in terms of costing it. So what essentially that means is that because of budget secrecy, essentially, officials in HMRC were not allowed to know what the policy decisions were in DWP and vice versa, and therefore OBR was not able to discuss with DWP officials changes to HMRC benefits and vice versa. Now, I think there's an interesting question for the OBR as to whether they should be more insistent about being able to see this kind of thing. I think this is also partly related to the lateness of the decision-making process. And it may also be an issue about the capacity within the OBR, which doesn't, for example, have its own tax and benefit model to run some of these changes and come up with independent views of the effects. They have to take, I think, sometimes somewhat on trust, the numbers that are coming from the individual departments. As I say, I think the key thing here is it's quite surprising that the OBR is not in a position to talk collectively with officials from DWP and HMRC when the combined effects of the policy measures that are being taken obviously kind of depend on the interactions between those departments.
Absolutely, and if Robert Choate was coming next week instead of having been here last week, we would certainly be asking him about this, because obviously, you know, it is quite remarkable, you know, that they're not able to call on the expertise of the officials when, you know, given the kind of role that they actually have, and I would hope that would be something they develop further, and certainly next time we speak to Robert, we'll be asking him about that. And just a couple of points before I open up the session to colleagues. I mean, you've talked about new claimants receiving significantly lower benefits than they would have done before the July changes, both in your paper and your opening statement. And you go on to say that 2.6 million working families being an average of £1,600 a year worse off than they would have been under the current system, while 1.9 million will be £1,400 a year better off. Now, doing a quick calculation, the differential I've worked out just on that is £2.9 billion. So does that effectively represent a £2.9 billion reduction?
I think that number is broadly right. I can't remember the exact number. That is broadly right. There's a £2 to £3 billion cut in the universal credit spending relative to the spending that there would have been under the continued tax credit system. And that's essentially precisely what the Chancellor was aiming for back in the July budget. And it's driven by these. Particularly by the reductions in the work allowances, in other words, the amount that you can earn before you start losing the benefit, as well, of course, as the reductions in what you can get if you have more than two children. The reason that there's, I mean, because universal credit is significantly differently structured from tax credits, there are also some deliberate changes here. So the actually universal credit will, on average, be somewhat more generous to a group of particularly people in rented accommodation because of the way that the interaction with housing benefit works, and as a consequence of that, it would be particularly less generous to those who are owner-occupiers.
In fact, that's the point I was wanting to touch on, which is basically housing benefit. You say that there's one small but in the long run potentially important change made to housing benefit for social tenants. For new tenants only, housing benefit will be restricted to the equivalent private sector rate. Saying that won't bite much initially, saving £225 million by 2020. But had it been imposed on all tenants immediately, it would save more than £1 billion. So I'm just wondering if you can talk us a wee bit through the government's thinking on this and the impact on finances in the long term.
Yeah, so this is...
Individuals concerned, of course. So.
I mean, this is part of... The sort of context of this, of course, is that spending on housing benefit has continued to rise and rise really very strongly over the last 5 years, despite cuts in the generosity. And the cuts in the generosity have been... Whilst the so-called bedroom tax has had most of the publicity, actually most of the cuts have affected those in the private sector in particular, by reducing the limit to the 30th percentile of properties in a relatively broad area, and then only increasing that from, I think, 2012 in line with inflation, so that the amount of rent that you can get paid if you're a private sector tenant as a proportion of total rent is effectively falling over time. Now, what the proposal in the autumn statement suggested was essentially to limit for new tenants in the housing association sectors in the same way that it's limited for the private sector, because none of the rules I've just described at the moment actually affect tenants in the social sector. Now, whilst obviously most people in the social sector, including the housing association sector, are not above those private sector levels, actually an increasing fraction are, particularly given particularly if they're in if they have new tenancies which are set at a relatively high proportion of the private sector average rent, and a number of those will be above the 30th percentile of the 2012 indexed private rent. Our estimates are, as you say, about this would save about £1 billion if imposed immediately on all tenants. But the government has decided only to do this for new tenancies, and therefore the savings in the short run are very much smaller. At a minimum, one would expect over time that to hit the billion pound mark as everyone kind of flows through the sector. More likely, it will have a bigger effect than that, because you would expect average rents in the social sector over time to rise more than inflation, which is the cap on the private sector housing benefit levels. Now, in fact, over the next 5 years, one of the big announcements actually in the July budget was that social sector rents would be capped at 1% below inflation. So this won't rise over the next 5 years, but in the long run, certainly over the last 30 years, in 25 or something of the last 30 years, rents in the social sector, or possibly even over the last 30 years, probably 30 of the last 30 years, rents have risen more quickly than inflation. So you'd expect this to bite more going forward. Now, there's a final point on that is, I think, you know, there is a question about exactly where private sector housing benefit policy is going to go. At the moment, as I say, we have a world in which the amount of housing benefit I can claim depends on the 30th percentile rent in 2012 in the area that I live in. Now, is that still going to be the case in 2030? If it is, that will be somewhat odd situation in which in some parts of the country I might be able to get most of all of my rent, and in other parts of the country only a small fraction of it, depending on what's happened to relative rent levels. And if that is something that happens, then housing benefit will have been almost completely disconnected from the actual rent that anybody's paying. Now, there are reasons for thinking that might not be a bad idea, but it would be a very different situation to the situation we've been used to.
Percentile changes to say 25% or 35%.
Yeah, and then again, obviously that impacts in different directions. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for that. I'm now going to open out the session to colleagues around the table, and the first to ask questions will be Mark, to be followed by Gavin.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Johnson. Well, obviously, last week we had Mr. Choate before the committee, and he was indicating then, I think it would be fair to say, that the vulnerabilities that surrounded the £27 billion uplift, or money that was found down the back of the sofa, as he put it. And you seem to have indicated as well that there are, it wouldn't take a lot for that to start to ebb away. But one of the things that he mentioned during the evidence session was that the Chancellor has effectively front-loaded the giveaways off the back of that uplift, with a view that the revenues will accrue later and smooth things over the five-year period. So I guess my question would be, is that if that front-loading has occurred and then the reductions to that sum occur that you're indicating might well do, does that mean that essentially there isn't the ability to maybe sort of skim off the top, if you will, in terms of the giveaways that have been announced, because they've already happened, and that would result in deeper cuts having to take place over the remaining period?
I think it's two things to say. I mean, first of all, that £27 billion number, it's a number that annoys me, because it's one of these numbers that's accumulated over, I can't remember if it's 4 or 5 years. So it's actually nowhere near as big as it sounds. And the and actually, in terms of the Chancellor's target, he's looking at 2019-20, and I think the forecasting changes are about £4 billion in that year. So it's, £27 billion isn't quite as big as it sounds. Secondly, as I was indicating, a £4 billion change in forecast 4 years out is almost neither here nor there, and it's it is slightly odd that the Chancellor should be making big decisions about whether or not to protect the police on the basis of something which is going to shift around by more than £4 billion probably at every subsequent fiscal event. Thirdly, you're right, the in terms of looking at what was planned, particularly in terms of spending cuts, if you look at the implied profile of cuts, they have become much, much flatter, so that actually we're still aiming to get at much the same place as we always were in 2020. It's just that instead of going a sharp down and then a little bit of up, we're going on a sort of very gentle glide path. So the protection relative to previous expectations is coming in those early years, with the implication that if we do need to do more in 2019, then any change between 2016 or 2017 or 2018 and 2019 will have to become sharper, so it becomes more difficult, as it were, to achieve steep spending cuts in a single year. I mean, that's one of the sort of general, it's one of the consequences of having such a an inflexible but also kind of stark fiscal rule that is, and it will become more stark as we get closer. So supposing in 2018 forecasts change significantly for 2019, you have to make changes really quite quickly in order to meet your, I mean, really quite astonishingly quickly in order to meet your rule. And even 1 year out, forecasts change quite quite significantly. So you are sort of the long answer to your question is yes, I agree. Sort of the short answer to your question is yes, I agree. This the relative giveaways were in the early part of the parliament. It will become more difficult if forecasts change to make the sharp adjustment to meet the target in 2019.
Presumably, then, as you indicated, that it becomes more difficult to make sharp cuts in a 1 year period. Presumably then the only option that's left on the table for the Chancellor, well, the only two options left on the table for the Chancellor are either increase borrowing, which of course would interfere with his fiscal rule, or increase taxes.
That's the natural implication, yes. I mean, there are other things that, you know, given the way the accounts work, that you can do at the margins, like sell off more stuff, but broadly speaking, yes.
In terms of the... Is there a risk that we could be looking at in-year adjustments being made, or are we at a stage where it's too early to predict that? Because obviously, particularly of relevance to ourselves as a parliament, is obviously we rely on, you know, the budget being set at the beginning of the year and that carrying through. If there were to be sharp in-year adjustments, that obviously would have an impact on devolved services, as well as wider UK services, obviously, but particularly in terms of our ability to offset that, given the even if we were to take on board the powers that are coming, there would still be limitations to how much offsetting could be done.
Well, of course, over the last parliament there were a number of in-year adjustments announced as late as the autumn statement, quite often for the same year, which appeared to reflect, I don't know how closely, views about the degrees of underspending that were going on in any case. But those in-year adjustments in a couple of years over the last parliament were quite significant. Now, the way that the fiscal rule is construed, I think, would mean that if in, so for example, if in the autumn statement of 2018 you got a forecast for 2019-20 which had moved such that it looked like you were going to get a deficit in 2019-20, it wouldn't require an in-year adjustment in 2018-19, in other words, in the last 4 or 5 months of that year, but it would require at that very late date a change in the spending expected in the following year. So whilst I don't think it would necessitate in-year adjustments, it certainly might necessitate very close to year start adjustments, and potentially quite big ones.
And I guess that it's difficult to predict with absolute certainty, but the likelihood would be, looking at the current economic circumstances and the projected future economic circumstances, that if there were to be those adjustments either in year or late year for the following year, you're probably looking at it being more likely to be unfavourable than favourable adjustments. Would that be a fair estimation?
Well, I think the last couple of, you know, as I said earlier on, we've only got two more months information than we had back at the end of November, but most of that information has been bad, so I think that has moved the risks in that direction, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Good morning.
Mr. Johnson. Right, where do we start? You gave the percentage of 40, you said 45%, there's a 45% chance that the fiscal target will not be met according to the OBR. Does the IFS, are the IFS as bold as that in having an actual percentage of what they think, or if not, what is your own personal view?
Well, that's, I mean, that percentage, I mean, that calculation by the OBR, I think, is based on a methodology that we developed at the IFS, and that methodology is essentially to say, it's not terribly scientific in a way, sure. it's a look back at what's happened over the last 30 years and looking in each of those 30 years, looking at forecasts 5 years hence, how wrong have they been by how much, and then assume that you're in sort of similar position now, looking 5 years hence, what's the likely error based on errors that we've had in the past. Now, it may be, you might think actually that errors might be less because you've got an independent OBR which might be doing a better job of and a more honest job of forecasting, or you might think we're in a relatively stable sort of growth path which isn't going to change dramatically, in which case you might sort of put the confidence intervals tighter. Equally, you might think, well, actually we remain in a very, you know, very much unknown territory in terms of the way that the economy is developing. There's all sorts of things going on externally. There's the chance of leaving the European Union. So actually there may be more uncertainty than usual, and actually, you know, the confidence intervals might be wider. Actually, I don't know which of those worlds we're in, which is why I think actually just basing this on sort of historic experience may just be the best that we can do. And so it's really historic experience which is telling us that there is that degree of uncertainty, and I think that's probably the best shot one can give at putting a number on that. And it kind of makes sense as well. I mean, 45%, you know, it's just better than evens, and that's because, in a sense, you've got you're looking at a 10 billion surplus, which is 10 billion out of 800 billion is pretty small, so you wouldn't expect 4 years out it to be much, you know, very, very much better than an evens chance.
Okay, thank you. Now, we've heard about some of the bad news that's come out recently, whether it's what's happening to the FTSE, whether it's concerns about China or so on. Are there, from where you're saying, though, are there potential positives and opportunities on the horizon as well that can help the 55% more likely to be the one that happens? So the thing, I mean, it's easy to predict or to look at things that we ought to be concerned about. Are there things that you can see on the horizon that you think actually there are a few things out there that might help us to do slightly better than projected?
Well, I mean, there remains a lot of uncertainty about, in particular, the degree of unused capacity in the economy. There are certainly forecasters out there who think that the OBR is being unduly pessimistic about the level of unused capacity and therefore the capacity of the economy to grow. And that's really a judgment about how much continues to be dispute about how much capacity was lost following the financial crisis. Now, the consensus is moving towards the kind of place where the OBR is, but there are certainly some who think that there's significantly more capacity there, essentially don't believe that we could possibly have lost permanently as much as might appear since 2010. And that's reflected to some extent in, you know, whilst unemployment is very low, there's still quite a lot of part-time work and self-employed workers who might want to move into different roles, and there's still quite a lot of capacity for companies to invest, for example. Equally, on the earnings and productivity side, it may be that there is some catch-up still to come. I mean, they have done very poorly over the last 5 years. The OBR's judgments are essentially based on an assumption that the growth moves to a normal place and that everything we've lost over the last 5 or 6 years is lost forever. It would only require us to get a bit of that back again to make a fairly significant difference to the forecast. I think if earnings are 1% a year more than is expected, then the forecast changes really quite really quite significantly over the medium term. So there are quite a lot of things to which these forecasts are sensitive, and hence the uncertainty around them. There's a lot of uncertainty still in the direction of the economy, because we are still in unknown territory, and some of that uncertainty will be on the upside as well as on the downside.
Thank you. Just for clarity, can you just explain again the £27 billion figure, which I think you said annoys you? It annoys you because is it effectively quadruple or quintuple counting? Or
It's accumulated over several years, and so it's very difficult to make sense of. I mean, if you accumulate over enough years, any number gets big.
Right.
there's nothing special about accumulating over, I can't even remember whether it's 4 or 5 years it's accumulated over. In terms of what the Chancellor's aiming at, the number is 4 billion, and that I think it's 4 billion, which is the difference in the forecast for 2019 as a result of these forecasting changes.
Okay. You've just provided my favourite quote this week: if you accumulate over enough years, any number looks big. I think that's one to stick with. If we come back to, you talked a little bit about the unprotected departments and the gearing effect. So this time round, quite small changes because of the gearing meant actually the cuts were reduced substantially, as you said. If the opposite happens then, if the next forecast, I mean, you know, the next one's only a couple of months away. Let's say the next autumn statement then, which is obviously a bit further away. If we have movement in of the same magnitude in the opposite direction, you know, is the likelihood that the gearing effect could work in the opposite direction effectively?
Well, I think that's the I do think that is the big question about the next 2 or 3 years. I mean, the obvious arithmetic answer to your question is yes, that's what would happen. I mean, the sort of the more realistic answer, do I really believe that if that happened and the Chancellor needed to find 10 billion of additional cuts, he would move back to whatever it would require, a 20% cut in police funding and an additional 10% on local government funding and so on? I don't know. I mean, I think it's it would be a strange world, as it were, in which what you thought was the appropriate funding of some of these core public services bounced around by a significant amount as a result of what are relatively small forecasting changes. I think that would be an odd kind of world to be in. And I think the Chancellor would try to avoid doing that, either by raising taxes or by finding some other changes in the accounting or by putting his fiscal rule out further. But if he's, you know, if in a way this is what it appears to be, a residual, so it's, you know, I will not put up taxes further, and I'm absolutely committed to my fiscal rule, and I will protect those departments which I've said I protected, then these unprotected departments are the residual, and they are the things that would suffer. But, you know, I think that would be, if the Chancellor found himself in that position, that would be some of the biggest political and economic choices he would have had to have made, and I don't know quite how he would jump. But as I say, arithmetically, if those other things are fixed, then that's where the adjustment has to come. It's worth saying on the tax side, you know, as I said, there have been some quite significant tax rises announced in July and in the autumn. So tax rises, most of which were not in the Conservative manifesto. So, you know, we have seen, as it were, some willingness to raise taxes, and, you know, maybe there'll be further willingness to do that. I don't know.
Okay, thank you. You just mentioned tax rises, so let's move on to one of them. One of them is obviously the supplementary charge on stamp duty land tax for second or additional homes. Has the IFS done much work on looking at the potential behavioural impact of that? Could that have a market impact more widely than just on second homes? Or what work have you done on it?
We've not tried to, and I don't think we could estimate what the effect of that will be on house prices, for example. I think I'd say two things about it. One is the rationale given, I don't think, is a terribly good rationale, which is that, in a sense, that those who are buying to let out are significantly better treated by the tax system than owner occupiers. I mean, essentially, I just don't think that's true. Owner occupation is still relatively favoured in the tax system. I think a much better rationale would be we as a government want to increase owner occupation rates for whatever reason. One of the things reducing owner occupation essentially is that there is a group of the population who are asset very rich, essentially, you know, people over the age of 50 who may have bought a house some time ago, paid off the mortgage, have done relatively well for occupational pensions and so on, may have inherited something, and they are competing in the housing market because they want to buy second houses, because actually they've seen that over the last 30 years this is a very good investment. That's pushing up prices more, and generationally speaking is disadvantaging younger people who want to get into the housing market. And from a sort of equity point of view, we would rather how home ownership was spread out across that population, and therefore we want to find some way of disincentivizing or discouraging people from moving into the housing market as second owners. Now, that seems to be a coherent argument. It's not the argument that the government put, but I think that would be a more coherent argument. The other thing I'd say here is it feels slightly odd, as it were, to be protecting those who are already second owners in this market. So this is only going to be penalising effectively those who want to move into being second owners. It leaves those who have already benefited, broadly speaking, protected.
Okay, but in terms of behavioural impact, you've not had the opportunity. You're not planning to do what?
No, I think that would be quite difficult, frankly.
Sure. Okay. And I'll finish just with one other slightly difficult question. In your view, when are interest rates going up?
I don't know. I mean, seriously, it's not actually part of our remit to do that, and we try not to make forecasts.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you.
Jackie?
Small question, because most of it's already been covered. I wonder whether I might explore with you oil prices, particularly because both the OBR and the Scottish Government's own oil and gas bulletin have overestimated the price of a barrel of oil, and that's got significant consequence, I would have thought, for the economy and indeed the budget. Given that Morgan Stanley, I think yesterday or the day before, were predicting prices at $20 a barrel, at what stage does the OBR actually reassess their estimates, and how does that feed into the process?
Well, the estimates for direct revenues from the North Sea, I think, are pretty close to zero already, aren't they? So I don't think the immediate impact on those revenues of any changes will be great. The second question here is and I think it's one of the big questions facing the Chancellor in March, is he going to take advantage of this to, for example, increase tax on petrol? The price of a litre is now at its lowest level in real terms for, I can't remember, some considerable period. So it's, given what I think policy statement was in 2011 or 2012, which was that you'd have a balanced tax system whereby if prices were high, you would not increase excise duty, but if prices were low, that you would increase them, that would trigger an increase in petrol taxation. Now, I sort of wondered whether we might see that in the autumn statement. We didn't, and I'm now wondering whether we might see that in the budget, and I don't know whether we'll see that. So I think that is, given the other things we've been saying about the uncertainty around the public finances and so on, that is an obvious option, at least for the Chancellor. But it's worth saying that for other parts of the economy, this does provide something of a boost. Clearly, if people are paying less for their, spending less on petrol, they may well be spending more on other things. So in terms of the, in terms of the way the OBR looks at this, for example, there was a moment when people were saying, well, because petrol prices have gone up and we're getting more VAT on petrol and so on, that ought to be good for the public finances. The OBR did come back quite firmly and say, no, that's not true, because people are spending on petrol, they're now not spending on other things. Clearly the reverse is also the case. The thing I think they didn't account for in that, and I think has come as a surprise to quite a lot of people, is that there seems to actually be a correlation, quite a strong correlation between oil prices going down and poor performance in the stock market, which you might actually have expected to go in the other direction. And that appears to be associated with the drop in demand in China and some other countries, which has created the fall in the oil prices and the fall in share prices for oil exploring companies and so on, and has had this kind of negative knock-on effect, rather than what most models previously would have said, which is it would have a positive knock-on effect.
I'm curious, if you were the Chancellor, what do you think is the greatest risk you face? We've got oil prices, we've got fluctuating markets. You presented a bit of a doom and gloom picture, almost to condition us for what's to come. What's the greatest risk he faces?
My guess is that the risk he doesn't want to have to deal with would be leaving the European Union. I think the uncertainty around the impact of that on pretty much every aspect of the economy would be a very tough thing for the Treasury to deal with. Now, what the long run, what the effect in 10 years might be, I don't know. But the effect in the short run would be quite a lot of volatility in one direction or another, I would have thought. And that dealing with that risk within the current set of fiscal frameworks and given the current set of forecasts, I think would be one that he wouldn't want to face.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. John?
Thanks, Convener. We've obviously covered quite a lot of ground already. Just to go back to the 3% on, well, stamp duty land tax in UK, land building transaction tax in Scotland. You said that was ill-designed, and Gavin Brown asked you about it as well. And the whole concept that you're protecting existing owners, I mean, what was the alternative to that then? Maybe say doubling council tax if you've got a second home, or are there alternatives?
Yes, I think the obvious. Again, it depends what you're trying to achieve. But if you wanted to increase taxation on owners or occupiers of second homes, then the obvious thing to do would be to do something with council tax rather than with a transaction tax. I think doing those to get, as I say, it does depend what you're trying to achieve. I think what the Chancellor is trying to achieve is what I tried to set out earlier, which is actually about changing the balance of power in the market between generations, actually, as much as anything else, or certainly between those with substantial assets and those with less assets. And so part of that I'd have thought to be increasing the cost of owning it, as well as the cost of buying it. And the cost of owning it you can reflect most clearly in council tax. You might also think that there was something more equitable about that, in the sense of hitting those, as it were, who are already property wealthy, as opposed to those who are merely wanting to become property wealthy. But I do think the crucial thing here is to be absolutely clear about what you're trying to achieve. And my kind of problem, as it were, with the way that this was described is that it does not achieve, as it was described as achieving, it does not achieve some kind of balance in the tax treatment between owners of first properties and buy-to-let landlords. That's not what it's achieving. It might achieve something else which you want to do, but it doesn't achieve that kind of levelling of the tax playing field.
I mean, we've still to really explore this, because it's only just kind of been announced, and I think we'll be doing that later on this morning, in fact. But I mean, one suggestion is that actually it'll be very easy for people to avoid this tax, and it may raise very little at all, because people will incorporate, or they'll just say, oh, this is my next new home, I'm going to sell the old one, and then they never do sell the old one. So, I mean, would you be concerned about the amount of money it'll raise?
I'd certainly be concerned about the amount of complexity that it might create, for exactly the reasons that you describe. I mean, that, certainly, any kind of incorporation is clearly benefited by this. Exactly as you say, where the line is between, I'm buying this with a bridging loan whilst I'm selling my old house, or I'm buying this a second. It will create many pages of tax law, and I'm sure, I suspect the Treasury, and HMRC will find a way of raising a significant amount of, you know, reasonable amount of money with it, perhaps not quite as much as was intended, but I think they will do that by imposing quite a lot of cost on people, which is not financial cost, but just kind of bureaucratic cost.
Okay, that's helpful. And the other area I wanted to touch on was just the last section on your comments was about covered devolution and not just Scotland, but a kind of variety of that. And you specifically mentioned the 12.5% corporation tax rate that's expected in Northern Ireland in due course. I mean, is there a risk? Is that just a minor interest to us and the rest of the UK because it lets them compete with the Republic of Ireland? Or, I mean, could that have an impact on the whole of the UK's taxation income because companies like Starbucks might go to Belfast in order to pay less tax?
I think it might. You know, this will be a, this is quite a big change in the UK tax system. I mean, there's always, as you know, we've had a single corporate tax system, and this will clearly provide incentives to be, registered in Belfast as opposed to London or Edinburgh. Now, again, there will be reams of legislation around this to try and control that kind of behaviour and activity, and there will be very clever people trying to get around it. So I think how it develops, I think is HMRC and Treasury are worried about how it will develop, and they'll be keeping a very close eye on it. It's worth also saying that this is, if Northern Ireland goes down this route, they will be taking a major gamble with their own budget because this will cost them something like £250 million in the first instance. I'm pretty sure Treasury will make sure that they bear that cost, and therefore there's first of all a question as to whether they will ever recoup it or when they recoup it, and secondly, how their budget responds in the meanwhile to cover that significant upfront cost from it. So I think the way in which it might be implemented and how the devolved budget copes with that will be at least as interesting as how firms respond and how Treasury and HMRC try to stop them responding.
Thank you. And I mean, you also mentioned in that kind of same section about fiscal framework and we still don't know how devolution to Scotland will work in practice and things like that. I mean, does that have any impact on the UK's finances as a whole? Or is it purely a question of, well, maybe there's an extra £100 million to spend in Scotland and £100 million extra spend in Birmingham or that kind of thing? It's a purely internal thing. Or is there any, I mean, you're mainly looking at things from a UK perspective. Does these issues affect the UK as a whole?
Yes, they can, because for two reasons. First of all, the way that the block grant adjustment is made. Obviously, if the way in which that is determined going forward is more or less generous to Scotland, then definitionally it's more or less generous to the rest of the UK. Now, obviously, the gearing ratio means that it matters a lot more to Scotland because £1 billion in Scotland is a much bigger proportion of the budget than £1 billion in the rest of the UK. But in some of the work that my colleague David Phillips and indeed David Bell here have done together on this. Their work suggests that reasonable alternatives could make a difference of £1 billion over a 10-year horizon. So, but that's a zero-sum game. That's £1 billion that Scotland does or doesn't get, which the rest of the UK would or wouldn't get. So I think that's one part of it. So yes, there is some of this is a zero-sum game in terms of how much goes where. The second part, I think, is the more complex bit, which is to do with how if at all, that framework is designed to compensate or otherwise rest of the UK for changes made in Scotland. So, for example, if you, or indeed the other way around. So if you were to make a change to income taxes which brought income or people from the rest of the UK to Scotland, would you need to compensate the rest of the UK for that, or vice versa in terms of what the rest of the UK does? Now, my guess is we'll end up with a framework which doesn't try to do that, because I think it's just too hard. But you know, you might think that there might be elements of that in there, and if there were, then exactly how that's designed would make a difference. I suspect the first thing that I said is more important, though, the actual way in which the block grant adjustment is indexed. And you know, David set out three different alternatives to that, will result in different amounts of money being distributed between Scotland and the rest of the UK.
Presumably long term, if Scotland got a raw deal and we had more poverty here, then that would impact the whole of the UK, but hopefully that wouldn't happen in the short term. Yes. Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, Jean.
Thank you. I wanted just to ask you about the policies that are set in order to have a reduction in the national debt, and that everything seems to be geared towards that. I mean, is there, what happens after that? What is the thinking behind the kind of austerity policies that we see?
Okay.
And the vision for at the end of, you know, it was going to be cleared in, by the end of the last government term, and now there's an ambition to have it cleared. And a lot of people are just thinking, well, you know, we have to live through this because then something interesting is going to happen. But in the meantime, you know, there are three new food banks opening every day, every week in Britain. And who looks at the kind of devastation of that? And earlier on, you talked about the changes to the welfare system. So it had to be delayed by a bit. But actually, I think it was, you know, stopped because of the extraordinary havoc that it would wreak on people at the very bottom end of the income bracket in this country. So at what point do you have an opportunity to reflect on that and challenge the Chancellor to some of these policies?
Let me take the first part of that question first, which I think is about what's happening to the deficit and the debt and what the plans are. So so you're right. The original plan was to have the deficit broadly sorted by now. It's now to get to balance in 2019. To be clear, though, the debt will still be something like 75% of national income by 2019. Now, the government's plan beyond that is to run a surplus each year in normal times after 2019. Now, the reason they would give for that is that even on that basis, even running a surplus at the level planned for 2019, every year through to the mid-2030s would only bring debt down to where it was just pre-recession. And that's even if there were no further recessions. If there were one additional recession, which frankly we might expect between now and the mid-2030s, then debt would still be in the mid-50%, even with a surplus in normal times by the mid-2030s. So that would be, the thinking behind getting to surplus and then trying to maintain surplus over that period. In addition, it's important to be clear that over the period, even after the 2030s, we will continue to be in a world in which demographic change is putting additional pressures on the public finances. So what we're not aiming for, and what the government is not looking at, is, as it were, a wonderful period after 2020 in which the sort of floodgates can open and public spending can start rising significantly and so on. So this is not, as I understand it, a period of austerity to be followed by a period of plenty. Of course, huge amounts of uncertainty over all of that, but that I think is where the plan is, and that's what underpins why they're trying to achieve what they say they're trying to achieve. And and the reason they would say that's all terribly important is because I think if we were to enter another significant recession with debt at 70 or 80% of national income and then it were to rise to 120% of national income as a result of that recession, then the consequences of possibly losing access to the international financial markets or big increases in interest rates would be devastating. Now that's the, you know, that's the defence, and I think the issue is really kind of how much weight do you put on that potentially devastating outcome. It's not something that we've we've never defaulted on debt, but you know, it's in our lifetimes we have had to go to the IMF, we have had to we have had our economic policy taken over by the IMF in the late 1970s, and that's something that they want to avoid. I put a very small probability on that risk, but the consequences are very, very significant. So that's kind of, I think, what they're trying to achieve and why they're doing it as they're doing it. Now, the there is clearly an alternative to achieve the same thing whilst not cutting welfare and other spending quite so much, and that's to increase taxes. And you know, we have taxes about 36.5% of national income. That is relatively low by European Union standards, certainly by the standards of the EU15. I think it's one of the lowest. From an economic point of view, there's nothing to stop you having tax at 38, 39, even 40% of national income. That is a big political and social decision. Where we are on tax, actually kind of where we've been for the last 20 years or so, around 36-37%. But my view is that the big political economy debate really ought to be more around what we think is the sustainable size of the state and hence the sustainable level of taxation, rather than, you know, can we be borrowing 30, 40 billion a year every year going forward. I suspect there is significant risk associated with doing that into the long run. Now there are obviously costs associated with increasing tax, and that's why I think the trade-off there is so big. And the trade-off is exactly as you describe: those who are suffering from cuts in public spending, particularly there are those who are suffering, particularly from cuts in welfare, and the universal credit system for a group of individuals will be significantly less generous than the tax credit system. It's worth, in longer, and as I said right at the beginning, in longer term context, our spending on working age welfare will be at its lowest level for about 30 years, I think, by 2020. Though interestingly not our spending on in-work working age welfare. So the universal credit system in 2020 will still be very much more generous than the family credit system as it was back in 1997, and on average at least as generous as the tax credit system was in 2003. So it is important to be clear this is a reversal of some of what the last Labour government did. It's by no means a reversal of everything that the last Labour government did in terms of tax credits.
Just finally, on the, we recognise that there's benefit fraud, but it is always a very small amount compared to the amount of tax fraud or tax avoidance. What discussions are there around ensuring that companies registered in, offshore tax havens or whatever? How is there a frustration in the government that these companies should be hauled back and that Britain should get the tax that it deserves?
I think it's a very interesting question, because I think we might learn quite a lot more about that in the budget, because the government will have to start responding to the OECD's base erosion and profit shifting work, which is specifically looking at this question of how to ensure that companies are paying tax in the places essentially where their real activities are. Now there are a series of issues there. One is about how you define permanently resident, as it were, for the point of view of companies. And I think there are likely to be some changes to that. The government has indicated that it will want to change that in a way which is likely to mean that we get some more tax from some of these companies that you'd be thinking about. The second really big question, and probably the biggest question for the government, will be how it decides to treat interest deductibility for corporation tax. Now, this is one of those areas where the UK system is more generous than many other countries and significantly more generous than that which is recommended by the OECD. But it would be a big policy change and actually a reversal of what the Chancellor said in the past if he were to limit that tax deductibility. So this may be one of those areas where we don't implement what the OECD says is best practice. And then there's a third set of questions around how we whether we adjust our patent box, which is a lower rate of corporation tax on companies which can show that that comes from something which involves a patent, or whether we adjust that particularly in terms of evidence that the activity which got the patent actually occurred in this country. So there are a number of questions within the framework of what the OECD has been proposing, which the Chancellor, I hope, will be responding to in March. Again, it's important to be clear here, there are areas here where other countries see the UK as a place where companies go to pay lower tax than if they were in that country, if you see what I mean, because we have quite a generous patent box regime, we have quite a low corporation tax rate. So this is not all money that will be flowing to the UK. There will be other countries who are wanting to repatriate, sort of, as it were, profits which are currently booked in the UK to their country. So the actual impact on UK corporation tax revenues, I don't even know which direction that would go in if all of this is implemented.
Thank you. Just to follow on, that's concluded questions from committee, but I've got a few I want to ask just to follow on. I mean, in terms of the last question that Jean asked, surely there's an issue in terms of competitiveness. If you're running a Starbucks and I want to set up another company in a similar market and you're not paying tax effectively, but I am, then you've obviously got a competitive advantage which clearly skews the market. Is there... taking into account, discussions at OECD level, which will only drag on for a considerable period of time, to stop the UK just deciding that any money that's generated in the UK by businesses has to be taxed by the UK. I mean, what's to stop them doing that? Now companies may then decide they don't want to.
So it's defining this word generated, which is the
difficult. I think a lot of these places are actually fixed. For example, I mean, a Starbucks isn't going to move around, is it? It's actually in the high street. And if it's generating a certain income, which generates a profit, which is therefore subject to taxation, how can it therefore, how can the UK government, what is preventing, the UK government from taxing them based on that profit generated in that particular, area or within the UK itself? Or indeed, I realise other companies that it's more difficult, perhaps, but surely it's not beyond the wit of governments, even without an OECD agreement, which clearly would be beneficial to do that now, to an extent at least.
I'm part of the answer to you. It's a sort of it was a serious response. It depends what you mean by that word generated, and that is what underpins the international tax treaty. So, I don't want to get specifically in Starbucks, but one of the things that's going on here is that their profits are taxed elsewhere, and in particular in the Netherlands, because that's where the intellectual property is said to sit for the recipe or whatever it is, and therefore as part of actually an international tax treaty, legally binding international tax treaties. We recognise that those profits are partly earned, not generated here, but generated there, and the tax is paid there rather than here. There are genuine international there are internationally generated legal constraints on this, which is what the OECD BEPS process is trying to adjust to some extent to achieve exactly what you're describing, which is to ensure that the tax is paid more in countries where you and I might more reasonably think this is where the profit's being generated. So I think part of the answer is you can't really do this entirely by yourself. You have to do this as part of an international process, because None of these companies are claiming there are no profits being generated anywhere, but there are a set of international rules which determine where that generation is recognised and where that generation isn't recognised, and that's not something that a country that, like the UK, could necessarily just tear up and do by itself. It has to do it through those international processes.
The much used word of reasonableness doesn't really come into play, because I think the recipe for the coffee isn't too complex. Most of us can probably work it out. Jean, you want to come in with a supplementary here on this?
Do you think that that's going to be made easier or harder by the introduction of the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership?
I'm afraid I don't have a view on that at all. Sorry.
Can I move on to something else? Oil prices were actually raised by Jackie. Now, obviously, you talked about the possibility in the budget of potentially being an increase in terms of taxation. But everyone across the globe pays an internationally agreed price for oil, whatever that barrel price happens to be. So would that have an impact on UK competitiveness? Because ultimately, if there's a higher taxation level in terms of what is actually paid at the pump and for businesses in the UK relative to other countries, you know, would that have an impact? Because one of the things, one of the benefits, if you could say, in terms of the oil price fall has been that although it's been, you know, quite very damaging in the northeast of Scotland and very around Scotland, other industries have obviously benefited from that. Is there a kind of sliding scale in terms of taxation of oil, you know, whereby a penny increase impacts in terms of X thousand jobs? Is that a kind of model the Chancellor has and uses?
Whether the Chancellor has a model, I don't know. I mean, we certainly don't. You could probably create something like that.
Yes,
your point is an important one. I mean, clearly, in general, lower energy prices are good for economic performance. One of the consequences of increasing, I mean, there are two consequences of increasing taxes on petrol. One is clearly households have to pay more. Mm-hmm. A second is that because this is also paid by lorry drivers and van drivers and so on, businesses are paying more. So part of the cost of increased petrol prices is that I have to pay more for my food from the supermarket because Tesco's has to pay more petrol tax as well. I don't know. I mean, one would have to look at sort of input-output tables to see how much of that was impacting, of particularly taxes on petrol, how much of that impacted on international competitiveness. A lot of that will be domestic in the retail businesses and so on. Some of it will be in international business. The much bigger effect is around other energy, particularly electricity and the cost for heavy industry, whether it be steel or cement, where you know you're using an awful lot of energy in the production process. That's not really determined by petrol taxes, but it is determined by other energy taxes and green taxes and so on. And there you have to be, we clearly are, you know, increasing those taxes, but we have a quite extensive regime of protection for heavy industry users which are internationally exposed. There, I think you do have to be very careful because you clearly do risk driving industry offshore if you're not very careful about the way that you create those protections. I suspect that a few pence on petrol, whilst it will have some effect, is going to be pretty small relative to the effects you can have on those very energy-intensive industries for other bits of the energy sector.
With obviously the steel industry, the relative energy costs actually having being credited as one of the reasons why.
I think in reality that's not a big part of what.
But it
was
one of the ones that was actually quoted at the time. So basically, if fuel duty goes up, there will be an economic impact.
There's always, increasing taxes, okay. has an economic impact. Increasing a tax which is partly paid by business, and petrol taxes are partly paid by business, will have a somewhat direct effect on those businesses.
And
that is one of the costs of, you know, as I was answering one of the Jean's question earlier, you can have higher taxes across the economy. There are costs to higher taxes.
Yes.
The degree of that cost depends on how well you design those taxes and where you impose those taxes.
Yeah, but obviously it does have some impact on disposable income, etc., if you're putting up those kind of taxes. I'm just wondering, one of the things that we've talked about in previous years, but we've not really talked about today, it's not really in your paper, is productivity. What's your view in terms of where the UK is going in terms of productivity relative to our competitors?
Well, certainly where it's been has not been very... I mean, there's been a productivity problem across many OECD countries, but since 2008 that's been a greater problem in the UK than it has been in many of its competitors, following actually 25 years of really quite good productivity performance relative to our competitors. Now, partly that is a sort of arithmetic effect of the fact that our labour market has performed much better, so we've got a lot more people, but in less... In less productive roles. I kind of feel I'm probably repeating what I've said at previous sessions here. I still don't think we really understand exactly why that's happened. I don't think we know quite what's going to happen going forward. There does seem to be some evidence of improvement, not least because we've, you know, evidence in the fact that real wages have been growing, you know, reasonably well over the last year, 18 months. And the best projections suggest they will continue to do so, which is probably good evidence that there is some underlying improvement in productivity going on, as some of the effects of the, you know, the long-lasting effects of the recession and the financial crisis wear off. But I wouldn't put much money on, you know, that maintaining at 2-2.5% a year over the next 4 or 5 years.
I mean, the Scottish Government have said that over the last decade, Scottish productivity has risen 4% relative to the rest of the UK, so there's clearly a lot of potential for further productivity growth across the UK.
Well, there's certainly potential. I mean, the fact that we've had such poor performance over the last several years, and you know, we have, you know, increasing numbers of people in low-paid, low-productivity work is evidence of potential. The fact that our productivity is well behind the international leaders is, you know, very strong evidence that there is potential, and we know some, you know, there are some things we could do to unlock some of that potential, whether that be planning reform, whether that be infrastructure, particularly transport projects, whether that be improving education and skills. I mean, all of those things we would be good for productivity in the long run. The amount that government can do in the short run, in other words, what would improve productivity in the next year or two, I think is probably much more limited.
Yeah, in the long run, as you said, education, research and development, etc., infrastructure could lead to significant improvements.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I think again, there are different elements of that. I mean, I think, you know, we know, I think, with, you know, with a significant amount of certainty that, for example, building more roads or loosening planning rules would be good for productivity, but we know that there's a trade-off there as well. There's an environmental trade-off, there's a trade-off in terms of the impact on people living close to the additional building. We know that additional house building in growing areas would be good for productivity. And then there are things where, you know, we know it would be good for productivity, which is improving the education system, where I think we've actually probably just got less clarity about what the right thing to do is to make that work better.
Indeed. And just one last thing, it's just about sterling. Where do you see sterling going over the next year at all? Because I remember when I was growing up, there was always a mantra about the value of the pound, and it seems to be become less of a kind of issue. I know we had the euro crisis, etc., a few years ago, but and over the last decade or so and beyond, there's been quite significant differences in terms of the value of sterling relative to, for example, the euro. In the 1980s, the dollar value went from $2.40 to $1.07 and bounced back up to $1.50, $1.60, but it doesn't seem to be as much of an issue as it was in the past. So where do you see sterling fitting in over the next year in terms of the UK's economic objectives?
Again, this is definitely not something I'd want to make any kind of projection on. I think a lot of this is going to depend, obviously a lot of this is going to depend on what happens elsewhere, not just what happens in the UK. So how what happens in the Eurozone is going to be more important in terms of the sterling euro exchange rate than anything that happens in the UK. So if the Eurozone manages to remain stable, we avoid another Greek crisis. That's going to keep the euro doing a bit better. Significant additional quantitative easing in the Eurozone may weaken the euro relative to the sterling, just as quantitative easing here in 2010 weakened sterling relative to other currencies. I wouldn't really want to say any much more than that, quite honestly.
Okay, well thank you very much. That's been a very interesting session, actually, as always, Paul.
Always well, thank
fascinating.
You.
Is there any further points that you want to raise or to, make to the committee at this point?
No, I think that was plenty.
Okay, yes, fair enough. Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm not going to call a recess until 10 past 11 to enable a changeover of witnesses and to give members a natural break. I shall now reconvene the session. Our second item of business today is to take evidence on the revenue side of the draft budget 2016-17 from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, Constitution and Economy. Mr. Swinney is joined today by Sean Neill and Graeme Owenson of the Scottish Government. This will be the first year in which the Scottish Government will have responsibility for setting the Scottish rate of income tax, in addition to having full responsibility for setting and collecting the devolved taxes. The committee and the Scottish Government are therefore agreed that going forward, scrutiny of the draft budget will take place over two separate oral evidence sessions. This morning we'll consider the revenue side, and on Monday we'll take evidence on the expenditure side of the draft budget at our external meeting in Pitlochry. I'd therefore like to welcome Mr. Swinney to the meeting and invite him to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I welcome the opportunity to discuss with the committee the revenue measures that are associated with the 2016-17 draft budget as the first of our two sessions in the forthcoming days. In this budget, the Government is proposing a Scottish rate of income tax for the first time. I'm grateful to all the individuals and representatives who've contributed to the discussions that have taken place here before the Finance Committee on the Scottish rate over the recent months. From April 2016, the UK Government will reduce the income tax rates payable by Scottish taxpayers by 10 pence. And a rate agreed by the Scottish Parliament will replace this. I am proposing a Scottish rate of income tax of 10%. The decision to set the rate at 10% has been influenced by the limited nature of the income tax power currently available to the Scottish Parliament. The current power only allows for a single rate to be set and then applied to all three income tax bands, basic, higher and additional. This means that any increase would have necessarily inflicted an additional tax burden on lower income taxpayers. I could not support this at a time when the same people are already being adversely affected by the austerity programme of the United Kingdom Government. For the Scottish taxpayer, the proposed 10% rate is equivalent to the 10 pence reduction to be applied by the UK Government. This means that the overall rate of income tax for Scottish taxpayers will remain the same as that paid by other UK taxpayers in 2016-17. The proposed 10% rate is also revenue neutral for the Scottish Government's budget. The amount of tax raised by the Scottish rate of 10% will be equal to the reduction in the Scottish block grant. During the transitional years for the Scottish rate, there will be no reconciliation of the actual amount of Scottish rate income tax collected against the OBR forecast. This is the second time that I have set out proposals for the devolved taxes in the draft budget. I plan to maintain the rates and bands of land and buildings transaction tax at existing levels in 2016-17. That will ensure that 93% of home buyers will either pay less than under UK stamp duty land tax or pay no tax at all in the year ahead, and ensure that Scotland remains an attractive and competitive location for business investment. In order to ensure that opportunities for first-time buyers to enter the market in Scotland are as strong as they possibly can be, and to make certain that tax changes elsewhere in the UK do not make it harder for people to get onto the property ladder, I will be seeking Parliament's approval to introduce an LBTT supplement on additional homes. I welcome the committee's call for evidence on this measure and look forward to engaging further with the committee on the issues once the legislation is before Parliament. I also plan to increase the rates of Scottish landfill tax to £84.40 per tonne at standard rate and £2.65 per tonne at the lower rate. This ensures that the tax burden is increased in line with inflation and addresses potential concerns about waste tourism by maintaining parity with rates in the rest of the UK. The credit rate for the Scottish Landfill Communities Fund will remain at 5.6% in 2016-17. The Scottish and UK governments have agreed a provisional one-year block grant adjustment for the devolved taxes in 2016-17 of £600 million. The Scottish Government's forecasts for the devolved taxes have again been independently reviewed and assessed as reasonable by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. In total, we forecast that the two devolved taxes will raise £671 million in 2016-17. For the first time, we've also published five-year revenue forecasts for the devolved taxes in order to provide transparency over a medium-term assessment of Scotland's devolved public finances. I welcome the challenge which the Fiscal Commission brings to bear on the Government's forecasts, and we will respond by improving the robustness of our forecasting methodologies over the next year. On local taxation, we have provisionally set the non-domestic rates poundage at 48.4 pence, which matches the 0.8 inflationary increase in the English rate. We have also provisionally set the large business supplement at 2.6 pence levied on properties having rateable value over £35,000. We also propose to limit renewable energy generation relief to schemes incorporating community ownership and to reduce levels of empty property relief. For empty industrial property, 100% relief is retained for the first 3 months of the property being empty, after which time the level of relief is proposed as 10%. For standard commercial property, 50% relief is proposed for the first 3 months of the property being empty, after which the level of relief is 10%. We have committed to reviewing the non-domestic rate system to ensure that it minimises the barrier to investment, is responsive to economic conditions and supports long-term economic growth and investment. We will confirm further details in due course. I look forward to answering the committee's questions this morning.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that opening statement. First thing I'll ask you about will be the Scottish rate of income tax, and the decision taken by the Scottish Government in terms of taxation levels is broadly in line with the evidence that we've received, certainly from the majority of people who have given evidence to the committee. For example, the STC's view is that having been through an historically unprecedented collapse in new wages over the last 5 years, 2016-17 is not the moment in which to increase taxes on the lower paid. And they've also said that SRIT is clearly a regressive tax. On that, though, have you looked at behavioural responses in terms of taxation? Because this is one of the issues, of course, which the committee deliberated on, particularly given the evidence from David Bell, was the impact of potential behavioural responses from taxpayers. So clearly this is going to be an issue in the years ahead, but I'm just wondering for this year, in terms of Scottish rate of income tax, has there been any analysis carried out by the Scottish Government of potential behavioural responses?
The first thing to say, Convener, is that I think it is important that when we consider tax measures that we do as much as is possible to develop our thinking and our methodology on behavioural responses, and that's a general observation in relation to the tax powers that we will now exercise. On the Scottish rate of income tax particularly, the analysis in this respect has been looked at by HMRC and looked at by the Office for Budget Responsibility, based on the fact that clearly behavioural analysis within the United Kingdom income tax system, over which the UK government obviously has had control over many years, has been developed. So that we've had access to that material and have considered that material, although it would have to be said that the analysis of behavioural response, obviously behavioural response because the tax rate is the same, I think is well, it's either negligible or non-existent. But
I mean is that when you decided to set it to be the same as the UK, was the potential for behavioural response taken into account when you set that specific rate? Obviously, there'll be no real behavioural response if it's going to be exactly the same. But what I'm saying is, did potential behavioural response influence you? Because obviously, 1% of taxpayers pay 20% of taxes. So that's going to be an issue as we go forward. I mean, obviously, the point about SRIT is that the 10p's across all band rates. But I'm just wondering whether that in general there was any consideration of behavioural responses before deciding where you would
I think if you include the consideration that I was very mindful, my primary consideration about my decision on the Scottish rate of income tax was the fact that because the lockstep existed, it would have to increase the tax burden on lower income individuals, and that was my primary consideration. So if convener, your inquiry about behavioural response looks at, well, what did I think it was appropriate to increase that burden on those individuals, then I didn't think that was appropriate, so therefore if that's included within behavioural response, then clearly that was my primary consideration in coming to this decision.
Clearly, in terms of the new taxes that will come in from April next year, you'll be looking, I take it, more at behavioural responses in terms of different kind of income groups?
Yes.
Because you won't obviously have the kind of lockstep you've talked about, you'll have much more flexibility.
And I think that is one area that I will be doing work on. You mentioned Professor David Bell. Professor David Bell has done published some material on behavioural responses already, and my officials are undertaking some of this work because I think it clearly there is more flexibility inherent in the income tax variation powers that will come through the Scotland Bill 20, the Scotland It Bill 2015. And it is important that when Parliament makes its judgment on these questions, it is informed by as advanced behavioural analysis as we can possibly develop in that process.
The reason I'm kind of pushing this a wee bit is because obviously there's been all sorts of evidence that a 1 or 2% difference, for example, might not make any real difference to behaviour. For example, if it's imposed on higher tax earners a year from now, a higher amount may actually, and it's where that actually starts having an impact, I think, that's obviously of interest. And on that same theme, I mean, has there been any impact, do you... are you aware of, in terms of the identification of Scottish taxpayers? Because while there is no change, and the Scottish Government have made that clear for the year ahead, is there any evidence that people are identifying more than would be anticipated as Scottish taxpayers, or less? For the minority that do have that ability, you know, people who tend to be more mobile, is there anything at all that we have on that at this early stage?
There's nothing really that's emerging. The expectation was that we would be dealing with about 2.5 million individual taxpayers, and that's roughly the number of letters that have been issued by HMRC and in the to identify Scottish taxpayers, and I hope that members of Parliament have all received those letters. It was anxiously awaited in the Swinney household to see if the system was working properly, but it dutifully arrived. So there's nothing that we're seeing so far that is suggesting that is delivering any form of differential pattern. What was expected to come back has come back, and the level of HMRC were unclear, understandably, about what the dispatch of these letters would generate in terms of traffic and communication, but it's actually been significantly lower than would have been anticipated, and really actually not a particularly significant amount of traffic has come back on. In terms of the last information that I had heard about this, and I've not heard anything that's to change my view on that.
Thank you for that. Now, in terms of tax release, the Revenue Scotland and Taxpayers Act 2014 introduced a general anti-avoidance rule in respect to the devolved taxes, and the GAR is broader in scope than the UK general anti-abuse rule, as its focus is on tax avoidance rather than abuse. However, as SRIT will not be fully devolved, the Scottish GAR will not apply to it. Is that a concern at all?
I say so, because income tax, the income tax power that we have is on non-savings, non-dividend income. So it's a much more tangible, an identifiable level of income that has to be considered as part of this process. So, income tax, non-savings, non-dividend income tax is at the more difficult to avoid, more difficult to conjure up ways of getting around end of the spectrum. So I don't think there's a particular difference that arises out of the fact that it will be UK legislation that will determine those points.
Thank you. Now, obviously, the block grant adjustment, you know, is of paramount importance, and I know you've made it clear that index deduction per capita is the best way to proceed, and I think we would all actually agree that seems to be the fairest method. We've taken significant evidence and discussed that at the committee. But if we're looking at actually in terms of devolved taxes for the year ahead, you mentioned in your opening statement about the £600 million one-year agreement. I'm curious as to how that's been reached, because the Scottish Government has forecast revenues of £671 million, again, as you mentioned in your opening statement, for land buildings and transaction tax and landfill tax, but the OBR has forecast £627 million, and the midpoint of these forecasts is £644. I'm just wondering how the adjustment of £600 million has been arrived at.
It was arrived at in discussion between the Chief Secretary to the Treasury and myself, and I think what to be fair to the Chief Secretary, one of the issues he was mindful of was he did not want me to be in the position I was in the previous year, whereby I essentially had to set a budget to Parliament without knowledge of the block grant adjustments. So he was keen to agree a definitive number that would allow me to base a budget upon. That was I'm grateful to him for that understanding. When it came to arriving at the agreement, and I should stress that this is I don't have the exact wording in front of me, but it's a without prejudice. It will be reviewed in the light of outturned data after 16-17. But it enables us to set a budget with some confidence around that particular number. And it was arrived at essentially by looking at the different forecasts that had been produced, the forecasts that had been produced at that time by the Office for Budget Responsibility, and then looking at the block grant adjustment for 2015-16, which is £494 million. Clearly, that number had to be inflated or indexed, whichever word we want to use. And we looked at different ways of doing that, either by increases in number of transactions or by values, and in looking at a number of different options, we settled on £600 million as a without prejudice number to enable us to make progress on these questions. We obviously had the benefit of outturn data for 2014-15, which, if my recollection is correct, was at £580 million. And we looked at different factors within that as a consideration and arrived at a number. I can't present to the committee a scientific analysis of how we got to 600 million. It was a range of different numbers were discussed, and we agreed that to enable me to make progress in setting the budget with a definitive block grant adjustment for that year. But obviously, it can be reviewed once the financial year is complete.
Thank you for that. Now, the committee previously raised concerns about the lack of transparency regarding adjustments to the block grant arising from devolution of further powers, and the Scottish Government consequently agreed a number of changes to the written agreement, saying that it would ensure the Finance Committee is kept informed of progress on any agreement or change to existing agreement with the UK Government on adjustments to the block grant arising from the devolution of further powers. I'm not really sure that's really happened in terms of this process.
What I would say, Convener, is that I acknowledge the issue and the agreement that was arrived at with the Finance Committee. And as I've said, and we begin to stray into territory here on the fiscal framework, because the fiscal framework has to be considered by this Parliament, and this Parliament has to be satisfied about its contents. And it's, I think the agreement that you talked about there, Convener, is very much in my mind as to what will be implicit in the understanding that goes on to ensure the committee is satisfied by the arrangements around future block grant adjustment. I think on this particular example, as with the one for 2015-16, these were one-off agreements around specific numbers. There's no real process put in place, but I would certainly take the view that for the establishment of the fiscal framework, there is a process of scrutiny this Parliament has to go through, which must involve the Finance Committee in some form. And then if that was to be revisited, but I would stress at this stage in the proceedings, my preference would be for us to have a fiscal framework and a block grant adjustment mechanism that we're not constantly revisiting, to give us confidence and clarity about how it's operating. But if that were to be the case, then I think the Finance Committee has to be closely involved and consulted about those issues.
Thank you very much for that. Now, in terms of land buildings transaction tax, it's quite clear that at the lower end, in terms of lower priced houses, there's been a significant growth in terms of sales and a boost to that market. But at the same time, the committee's budget advisor, Professor McEwen, has stated that market data has shown a significant reaction to the introduction of LBTT also at the higher end, and there's been a significant reduction in higher end sales as a result. And that's been reflected again in the evidence that the committee has actually taken from
witnesses. So while there's been a positive impact in middle and lower tiers of the market, with, you know, I quote, a new lease of life under the new tax regime, you know, with property sales in Scotland, first-time buyers and home movers increasing three times faster than the rest of the UK, the exact opposite appears to be getting mirrored in terms of the more expensive households. And obviously that's going to have an impact not only on the market, making it more sluggish at that end, but also on the impact the revenue impact for the Scottish Government. I'm wondering, therefore, whether or not the Scottish Government, why the Scottish Government is not reconsidering, albeit these taxes have only been in since April last year, a change in the tax level for these more expensive houses.
I felt that, well, the first thing to say is that I think the evidence is showing that, in general, the tax take that I think is going to come from the devolved taxes, I'm confident is going to fulfil the requirements of the budget. And now, the shape of that, as things stand just now, looks to be different to what was envisaged, with more taxation being generated through non-residential land and buildings transaction tax and landfill tax than was predicted, and less emerging from residential transactions. The shortfall in residential transactions is broadly comparable at this stage to the level of forestalling that's been identified or suggested by the Office for Budget Responsibility. And I would accept that there has been an effect of forestalling. It's, you can't look at the data without seeing there is a clear impact of forestalling, which my estimation came to a conclusion in August in relation to the impact on the market. So I think that would be my explanation about the numbers. Overall, we're going to reach the revenue that is required to support the budget, and I suspect we will exceed that total. Secondly, that the mix will be different. And thirdly, that the effect of forestalling is tangible within the figures on residential transactions. As to the final part of your question, Kavina, why did the government not revisit these things? Essentially, I looked at, frankly, at quite a bit of the evidence that the committee had taken itself, and it was helpful to have that evidence. And my assessment of the evidence that the committee heard was that basically individuals within the sector were saying, let's just see what a year does. Let's see what an overall year-long position does, and then we can revisit that. And we're not. And I think given the fact that the forestalling effect is so tangible, I think it would be prudent to wait to see the completion of a full year and perhaps longer to see what... you know, I'd be interested to see what a whole year looks like without any question of forestalling implicit in the system to come to those judgments.
I think that's a very fair assessment of the evidence. I mean, most of our witnesses said that they weren't calling outright necessarily for a change at this point, but certainly wanted it kept under review because there certainly were some alarm bells ringing, so perhaps a full year's data would be helpful. Now, in terms of data, the Scottish Fiscal Commission raised some concerns about the available outturn data for 2015-16 not feeding into forecasts for land buildings transaction tax, but it does for landfill tax. So the question obviously arises as to why that would be the case, why you would look at outturn data for one and not the other.
Specifically on landfill tax, our challenge with landfill tax is that we essentially have... not had disaggregated data or any form of creating a particularly robust disaggregated data picture for landfill tax within Scotland as part of the UK landfill tax system. So we've had a particular deficiency there, and I think when I look at the numbers, we are the forecast for 2014-15, if you'll give me a second, convener, while I just get the numbers in front of me. Our number, I think, was about 117 million, and I think we're heading for somewhere around about, I'd be surprised if we don't end up somewhere around about 140. Now, that's quite a significant difference And I would be the first to accept that we did not have a particularly aggregated base to arrive at that estimate. So therefore, seeing the pattern of experience suggests to me it would be prudent to take that forward for 2016-17. On land and buildings transaction tax, however, we do have a model that has been built up from granular data within Scotland based on the property transactions that have been undertaken within the country over many years. And that, I felt, was a much more robust empirical base of information that would enable us to form a judgment on these questions. The other point, Convener, is that I think I would be loath to attach too much significance to the outturn position at this stage on 15-16, given what I've just said about the significant effect of forestalling, because I think that would give potentially a distorted picture of what the market would look like.
Oh, sorry, I thought you were going to add a further comment on it. Staying on the LBTT, the SFC have raised a number of issues, and they say that there may be long-term behavioural responses to the new tax, which the current forecasting approach does not allow for. The behavioural factors should be included in the forecasting methodology as soon as practical. However, despite these concerns, the methodology still doesn't account for any behavioural response.
Well, I'm committed to further development work on behavioural responses. I think we've published the forecasting methodology paper, which the committee will have seen, and it goes through in some detail the modelling approach that we've undertaken and the approach that we've taken to behavioural questions. So I think there's a section on page 11 of the document around land and buildings transaction tax, which explores some of the questions around behavioural response and forestalling. And I'm obviously committed to enhancing the regime. On the particular question of the LBTT supplement, I have applied very significant behavioural questions to the assessment of those of that particular tax. It's so much so that an analysis that would take no account of behavioural response suggested that the revenue generated could be between 45 and 70 million in 2016-17. But once the variety of behavioural responses are taken into account, a more appropriate range would be 17 to 29 million pounds. And I have, of course, I've settled on the number of 23 million as what we could reasonably expect to be generated by that supplement. So I think by that measure, there is a very significant account been taken of behavioural factors in that analysis. Obviously, we are in a position in this financial year where the effect of forestalling is really of quite some significance. And I want to make sure that we don't provide undue significance to the data that comes out of this year, which may be influenced by the effect of forestalling.
Thank you very much for that. It's very clear. Now, I don't want to go into this in any great depth because obviously we'll be taking evidence specifically on it. But in terms of the LBTT supplement, you know, Professor McEwen has provided the committee with a briefing which looks at the potential difficulties in terms of actually realising even the 23 million that you've just mentioned, due to a host of different measures which can be taken potentially to avoid that tax, for example, by owning letting property through a company, because the supplement doesn't apply to companies. And there's a whole number of areas that he's went through there. How concerned are you that what should be a fairly straightforward measure could in fact become fairly complex if the Scottish Government has to, and its legislation, which will be brought in fairly quickly, has to bring in legislation to try and prevent such blatant avoidance?
I don't think, Convener, to be honest, that as I look more and more at tax questions, I don't think there's anything that's simple about tax, to be honest. So if that's the holy grail we're after, then I think we've, you know, I think we'll have a long search. So I do accept that there is a need for us to take care in trying to take forward what, on the face of it, looks like a simple proposition. We are engaging in consultation on these points, and obviously the committee will exercise scrutiny, and as always, I will be keen to hear the views of the committees, and some of the analysis that you have before you from Professor McEwen will be important analysis for us to consider. We have to make sure that we design a proposition that can actually meet the purpose that is inherent in the legislation, and that that can actually deliver the level of taxation that we envisage, and we have to ensure that we don't inadvertently take steps that somehow could make that task more difficult.
Point before opening out to colleagues, which is in terms of Scottish landfill tax, you know, the Scottish Community's Land Fund will remain at 5.6% compared to the UK's rate of 4.2%. What was your thinking behind that?
I felt that I've always been impressed by a lot of the projects that are supported by this particular measure, and I said that I would set the Scottish Landfill Community's credit at 10% above the UK rate. The UK obviously took theirs down. I just felt it was reasonable for us to sustain the level of support that we're putting in place, and to ensure that what are really quite critical sums of money to a number of community projects were able to be sustained in the years to come.
Thank you very much for that. Okay, first colleague to ask questions will be Deputy Convener, to be followed by Jackie.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, clearly the Scottish rate of income tax and whether it is progressive or regressive has been one of the issues we've been looking at, and I think the Convener's convinced it is regressive, and I think I'm convinced it's progressive. So,
I'm glad to hear there's such unity at the heart of the SNP members of the committee.
That's right. We're all independently minded here. We were given a piece of evidence by one witness that, if you compare somebody on 25,000 income per year and somebody on 125,000 per year, that is, the one is obviously earning five times the other. Adding 1.5p on SRIT would mean that the one on the lower level paid £216 extra and the one on the higher £1,875 extra, which is eight times. So although it's not very progressive, it does mean that when the income goes up five times, the tax paid goes up eight times, which strikes me as progressive. So I just wonder how you would respond to that kind of comment.
Well, I'm tempted to respond myself.
Well, I'm very grateful to Mr. Mason for inviting me to intrude into this private debate between himself and the convener, and I'm not sure, but I shall give my honest, straightforward answer, and won't, which has to be the case at all times in committees, but it will, I suspect, incur the wrath of the convener. I do view the Scottish rate of income tax power as a progressive power, because on the basis of the analysis that Mr. Mason has put together, and I don't have that particular example in front of me, but clearly people on higher incomes would pay comparatively more in taxation than people on lower incomes. The issue that was on my mind, and the issue that I raised with, well, the two issues that were on my mind, which influenced my decision in this respect, the first was that because of the lockstep, it would involve increasing tax for people on low incomes, and I take the STUC view on this, that this is not the moment to do that. People are finding it hard enough. And the second was that if I had increased the Scottish rate of income tax beyond 10p, as a percentage of current income tax, in the actual amount of income, the increase in an individual's tax bill would have been disproportionately greater for those on lower incomes than people on higher incomes. And on those two grounds, I just felt it was not an appropriate step to take.
I understand that, and I accept that the majority of witnesses took that view. On the other, including this. However, NHS Scotland, Health Scotland, I should say, did argue that if, even though it was taxing the people at the bottom end, by using that money to really help people at the bottom end, both earning and not earning, that that would could be compensatory and could be overall benefit?
There's obviously an interesting and substantial debate to be had here. I think the issue that would trouble me about that is that that requires a very refined form of targeting to support incomes. And I don't think at this stage today we have the powers that would enable us to undertake such a refined impact on people's incomes. Because essentially, if I understand the rationale of that argument, it is an argument which is almost about compensating individuals for a compensating some individuals for a tax increase that all individuals have taken. And I wouldn't be confident that we have the powers to put in place such a refined mechanism. Now, if we look, the tax credit debate is in a sense an example of the type of devices that you can take forward to try to get to that refined proposition. Now, that power isn't with us today, and I don't see anything in our range of powers. I may have discussed with the committee before the challenges I faced about the dealing with the reduction in the council tax benefit payments that were put in place by the United Kingdom government. Because the minute I went anywhere near the B word, the benefit word, I was in territory I'm not permitted to go into, which is why we ended up with a council tax reduction scheme, because I'm perfectly entitled, if Parliament authorises it, to reduce people's council tax. So we did it. Now, I think, but to get to a very refined mechanism of almost compensating certain individuals, and it's certain individuals, it's not all individuals, I don't think we would have the legislative competence to do that.
And just also on a Scottish rate of income tax, I mean, there's been questions already about the behavioural response. I suspect you'll get more. I mean, Professor Bell suggested that, you know, we kind of call canny and be careful even in 2 years down the line when we do actually have the powers. I mean, have you got any feeling as to what, you know, we could safely increase, hopefully, income tax, say, by 2%, and that would not really have much behavioural response, or would you not be prepared to commit to a figure?
When you look, convener, at the some of the analysis that's been undertaken by HMRC to inform this discussion based on admittedly, this is about Strict. This is not about the Smith powers. I think it would be, you know, the behavioural effects are, you know, the estimated behavioural effects do not appear to me to be particularly significant of the a variation in the rate, even of the extent of 2%. Doesn't look like it would be particularly significant. I think there are, but that's on Strict, and I think you explore different questions, and Professor Bell explores different questions in his paper about some of the other opportunities and possibilities that exist with the wider Smith Commission powers, which is why I think before we come to exercise those powers, we have to do some further work on the potential behavioural response to make sure we come to properly informed conclusions.
I totally agree we should do work and come to conclusions, but I mean, it has been raised with us that, you know, what is the point of having all these powers if, and at the moment, certainly, and I realise we're in early days, but at the moment, we seem to be doing the same as the UK on land and buildings transaction tax, on landfill tax, on income tax.
I take a different view. Like on land and buildings transaction tax, we're now at the stage where the convener's feeding me lines. this is very encouraging. But the convener is absolutely correct. We undertook a very significant reform of land and buildings transaction tax when it was implemented. And yes, the UK government went to a similar system. I've taken steps in the supplement to, for particular reasons, to try to avoid a situation where the market in Scotland was not distorted by a change that took place south of the border. And on, you know, my rationale for the Scottish rate of income tax has not been because it's, you know, I want to keep it the same as the rest of the UK. My rationale is I'm concerned about, in the exercise of this power, in this respect, it would have, it would impose a burden on people that I don't think are in a strong position to pay it at this stage. And we are, when we don't have the fine-tuned measures to try to take account of that.
Okay. On land and buildings transaction tax, we have this 3% extra for second homes, etc. Can you just tell me why there's a 40,000 minimum and why that figure was chosen rather than, say, nil or some other figure?
On the basis that there are very few properties below £40,000 that are selling on the market. And then secondly, I wanted it to apply essentially across essentially all transactions, which is why the £40,000 level was, in my view, an appropriate one to set it at.
So would nil not have worked just as well, or?
I suppose there is an argument for that, which, you know, the committee, we can consider that as part of legislation.
Now, you said you'd be consulting about all of this as we go forward, and there's obviously going to be a separate legislation on it. Are you consulting with Westminster? Because they're obviously doing something similar. I mean, is there going to be any kind of joined-up approach, or will we do entirely separate from what they do?
Well, we'll take our own set of decisions. I'm obviously, you know, the Westminster government have produced a consultation document which sets out some of their thinking. I've obviously considered that, and will continue to consider that and other issues. But it's we will take our decisions relevant here.
Okay, thank you. Now, on the more general tax, I mean, we've had various witnesses, and I have to say, quite a few representing, in my opinion, the property sector and people at the higher end of the property sector, who seemed to think it was a bad thing that there might be fewer transactions over £1 million. Now, my feeling is, if there was no transactions over £1 million, that would be a good thing, because that would show society was fairer and more equal. But, I mean, I do accept that at the same time, that means you would get less tax, at least in the short term. So, in one sense, I think if the top end is being squeezed and the bottom end is being helped, that's good, and I think that's what the tax was meant to do. But I suppose, how do you balance that up against actually seeing the revenues coming in?
That's where we've got to make a considered judgment in the round. And I think, you know, I'm very pleased with the effect of land and buildings transaction tax on the lower and middle ends of the market, the lower end and the middle part of the market. I think these are very encouraging trends that have developed and have provided new opportunities for people in Scotland, and that's helping the volume of transactions. Indeed, in the most recent quarter, July to September 2015, house sales reached the highest volume for any quarter since April to June 2008. So there is real movement in the housing market within Scotland, of a level we've not seen since the financial crash. So I think that's a very helpful indicator, and we've obviously seen a situation where, in the first 6 months of LBTT, over 5,700 additional house properties have been taken out of tax. All of that has taken place within a context where I believe that the tax that I estimated would be raised, and the budget and which underpins the budget, is actually going to be raised. So the housing market is stimulated. There are transactions that are out of tax that weren't previously out of tax, so people have not had to pay that to help them into the market, and we've managed to raise the necessary tax to support public services and the public finances. So I think that's a pretty encouraging start to the exercise of the powers around land and buildings transaction tax.
Top end of the market.
I've conceded already that there was a very clear effect of forestalling in the first few months of this year, and also in the last quarter of 2014-15. So from January 2015 to August, there has been a significant effect of forestalling on the higher end of the market. I can't escape that conclusion. what I think we now need to see is, well, what, now that that opportunity is gone for forestalling, what's the effect on the market? And we'll begin to see that in the course of the next the period that lies ahead.
Yes, if nothing else was changing, we'd be able to look back and see that in itself. But of course, we've now got the 3% coming in, which presumably there will also be forestalling for the 3%. So will they start getting mixed up with each other?
Well, actually, I'm not so worried about the forestalling on the LBTT supplement, because we will get the benefit of that.
Yes. But it'll be harder to measure, maybe, will it? Because even now, if that's happening...
Well, I think if you... The volume of transactions, I'm just trying to recall I don't think I've got the precise number at the front of my head, but I'm pretty sure that, and I can be corrected if I've got this wrong, that the 3% transactions that the LBT that are involved in the LBT supplement, transactions of that type, I think, represent less than 10% of the market. It's I better not give you that number actually, but it's not fundamental, and therefore I think, and also we will get the benefit of that.
Then, I mean, I think we were meant to get refunded by Westminster because with the previous forestalling, they were getting extra tax in, 14-15 that we've lost in 15-16. I mean, when and will a figure be agreed, and when will they pay it?
Well, these issues are tied up in the whole discussion around block grant adjustment.
Fair enough. The comment was made, I think it was by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, about with landfill tax, that the target equals the forecast. So our target is to get landfill waste down over a period, and that is the same as the forecast. And I think they were just questioning, should the target and the forecast be different at all, or are you totally convinced that the target is going to be achieved?
I think those are two different questions. I think it's right to link the revenue to be raised with the achievement of the targets, because if we didn't do that, we could have an expectation of higher tax being generated simply by, you know, if we kept the tax rate, if we indexed the tax rate to go up, our objectives on landfill tax are to have the volume of landfill coming down. So as the committee will see from the forward estimates, our forward estimates are for landfill tax to go from £142 million in 2000... The £142 million is where, if the first two quarters are replicated for the remainder of the year, is where we'll end up, down to £94 million in 2020-21. Now, if we didn't have a relationship between the tax to be generated and the exercise of the landfill tax policy, you know, we could end up expecting more tax than we could have any reasonable expectation of it being generated.
I was just thinking, you know, if we're expecting a reduction every year, well, maybe that could vary 1%, 2%, you know, more or less.
That's undeniable, yes.
Yes.
And I think, what we now have, I think, is better data and information upon which to predict what is our, you know, we can now see what we're generating in landfill tax much more visibly within Scotland, and we can also get more detailed information on the volume of landfill activity in and around Scotland. So if we apply the right estimations of the pattern of landfill reduction, then we should be able to get a better picture of what this involves.
Thanks so much. On the block grant adjustment, I mean, you've already been asked about that. Just for clarification, I think you said that the 16-17 adjustment, which, if I'm right, is 600 billion, million? can be reviewed afterwards. But I take it won't be changed afterwards. I mean, it'll just be that if that turns out to be different, then that'll affect the future year's adjustment. They're not going to go back and change 16-17.
Well, that, you know, we've agreed a provisional number to enable me to settle the budget, and I have to accept in a provisional number there is the opportunity for that to be reviewed, and that would be reviewed with the benefit of outturn data for 14, 15, 15, 16 and 16, 17. So, you know, obviously, the number could be reviewed. Given
so if we did better in 16, 17 for land and buildings action tax than we're budgeting, that could be taken back off us?
Well, it depends. It's the interaction between the tax raised and the level of the block grant adjustment. So it depends. I think terminology like could be taken back off us is, you know, is difficult because we have a provisional block grant adjustment number, we have a provisional tax expectation number, and, you know, we've agreed that those can be reconciled with outturn data once we see the pattern of the performance on tax. So there is the potential for those numbers to be revisited.
Okay.
And that would be informed by the outcome of the fiscal framework negotiations.
Yes. So, but our hope in the long term then is that there's a fixed agreement and it would not be changed retrospectively.
These comments apply only to the £600 million figure for 2016-17, and my hope is that we have a fiscal framework that just operates and operates in a mechanical fashion. So it's just for that 1 year.
Okay, and my final point was we had a good session last week with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and they've obviously been quite challenging to the government in some of the discussions that have gone on over the year. And for example, one of the things they said was in developing the forecasting methodologies has been slower. Progress in developing the forecasting methodologies has been slower than the Commission has hoped. And leaving aside the substance of that, I mean, it strikes me that's been good that they've been asking these questions and challenging that. And I suppose my final point would be if the Scottish Fiscal Commission was doing the forecasts, who would challenge them in that way?
Well, the first point is that I think anyone reading the material that's been published by the Fiscal Commission and looking at the interaction cannot come to any conclusion other than this has been a very vigorous process of challenge. Admittedly shouldered more by my officials than by me, but it has been a challenge. And there has been sustained challenge by the Fiscal Commission. That's what we set them up to do. And I think they have served Scotland well in exercising that degree of challenge. And I welcome it. And that's exactly what they're designed to do. I think there is an issue raised by Mr. Mason about, well, if the Fiscal Commission were producing the forecasts, who would challenge them? And who would challenge them as effectively as I think the government has been challenged by the Fiscal Commission? And I think Lady Rice made that comment to the committee, and Professor Hughes Hallett made that comment to the committee. And I think these are real issues.
Thank you, Jackie.
Followed by Mark.
Can I start just out of curiosity where John Mason left off with the Scottish rate of income tax? Because Cabinet Secretary, you said you didn't have those kind of, you know, finessed powers to compensate people. Given the example you gave of the council tax reduction scheme, but also we could have landed on the bedroom tax, is it not the case, just for my curiosity, that local government could well have a set of powers that you might have sought to utilise?
I don't think to give that degree of... Because the point that John Mason was raising was about... Like, if I take the numbers involved... for the sums of income involved, I think to try to compensate people requires a very fine level of accuracy and precision to... If the policy objective is to directly compensate, to actually make that possible and practical. And the two schemes that Jackie Bailey cites, there are eligibility criteria that drive those issues. And actually in the council tax reduction scheme, we have essentially had to mirror the arrangements on council tax benefit, but just in almost in a sort of flip side fashion to enable us to do that. And that's been a helpful, almost a navigation through this issue to make sure that we broadly got council tax reduction to the people that required to get that. What this particular income measure, I think we would have found it more difficult to reach. And then you also have to have a statutory basis for paying it. And the statutory basis exists on discretionary housing payments for bedroom tax. It exists on council tax reduction because we have legislative competence over the council tax. Income compensation, out with a provision such as the Scottish Welfare Fund, for example, I would be interested to hear how we could do that, but it would strike me as being something that would be really quite difficult for us to find a way, a practical way, that was within legislative competence to enable us to do.
I would interpret that as maybe not so much that there's no power, but there's not a sufficiently finessed power. Would that be fair?
I'm not sure there's much difference between the two, but I think the point I'm making is that to address the challenge that John Mason has said, you have to put forward a proposition that is really very individually focused and targeted, and I don't think the powers exist to enable us to do that at this stage.
Thank you. Can I turn to LBTT, but focus on the residential element, because that's where there's concern. It appears to be performing reasonably well, indeed better than forecast in the non-residential. I'm pleased that OBR have revised their forestalling figures. That will benefit the Scottish Government financially. But there is nevertheless a shortfall forecast to the end of the year. Now, I've sat here with you before, and you've accused the OBR of being incredibly optimistic in some of their forecasting, with some justification. I now sit here and look at page 16 of the Spice briefing that you may have had an opportunity to see. I would recommend it to you, where actually we have a complete reversal, and the OBR is much less optimistic than the Scottish Government. Indeed, for 2016-17, they estimate that there will be 40 million less in residential transactions. And as you take that table, helpfully, Scottish Government is in blue, OBR is in pink. The difference by the time you get to 2020 and 21 is over 70 million. Now, let me put that in the context of your own modelling on page 9, table 7, where you forecast the annual growth in volume of residential transactions, although positive overall, is declining. So we go from 5% this year to 1% in 2021. So I'm kind of trying to understand, has the OBR become suddenly much more pessimistic, and on what basis? Or, you know, why is the Scottish Government, given what we know about likely shortfalls this year, become so optimistic in the face of the evidence that you present yourself about declining volume of sales?
The first thing I should say is that I don't expect there to be any shortfall in revenue this year over the devolved taxes that underpin the budget of the Scottish Government. I think our budget is underpinned by requires 498 million pound in revenue to be raised, and I'm confident that will be exceeded. So I foresee no shortfall in the devolved tax revenues for
2015-16. That's overall. My question was in relation to residential LBTT.
Yeah, but just for the sake of clarity, that I don't envisage any shortfall in 2015-16 on residential tax. We are currently about £31 million adrift on residential LBTT, and the estimate of forestalling has now been revised up by the OBR to between 20 and 40 million, and a mid-range of 30. So in a sense, what that says to me is that the estimates that we have put in place, whilst taking into account the issue of forestalling, are likely in the right scope. Now, when I looked with interest at the contribution that Robert Choke made to the committee last week, it was an interesting discussion. And Mr. Choke said that although there were differences between the forecast, that I should also point out, actually, before I get to Mr. Choate's comments, that the estimate for 2015-16 from the OBR at the autumn budget revision was substantially revised down from the position that they had in July, and much more in line with the forecast that we have been making, and which has been validated as reasonable by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So I think that all of these changes are welcome, that we've seen that happening. And then looking at the forward revenue forecast over the next 5 years, Mr. Choate said that he ascribed the difference to the Scottish Government assuming slightly more rapid increases in house prices over this period, and also a higher assessment of the increase in the number of transactions over the period. And the number of transactions point is essentially us assuming that we will return to the average of number of house transactions within Scotland, which we've seen over some years. And I think on the whole, the way in which Mr. Choate characterised the difference between the OBR forecasts and the Scottish Government's forecasts over the course of the next 5 years, I can't remember the exact... he said, "I would not regard the difference between the two as being large in comparison to the uncertainty that lies around either of the forecasts in isolation," which I think puts this into its proper context. And the final point I would say is that the OBR in their forward, this is the first time we've done a forward forecast for 5 years. The OBR has done, I think, one before, and the most recent one was a substantial revision downwards of the figures that they had, and much more into line with our expectations.
That Mr. Choate certainly was very diplomatic and acknowledged that there were different forecasting models that were deployed. And I think it's interesting for us as anoraks to consider, you know, which is the more accurate as you move forward, because obviously trying to estimate yield is something that I would assume in government you would want to get, you know, as near perfect as possible. You did say that you thought...
Can I make a comment here, Kevin? And I think I accept that. And yeah. I accept that there is being absolutely precise about all of these figures is incredibly difficult in terms of predictions, particularly when we start going out 5 years. Hence, that's very, very difficult indeed. But the evidence that I would marshal around our plans around 15-16, where I would summarise things are just now, our residential forecasts have been undermined by forestalling. Our non-residential estimates have been exceeded by performance, and our landfill tax expectations have been exceeded by performance as well. And in the round, we are going to generate the amount of revenue that is required to support public services in Scotland. And for a first year of estimating and predicting tax, I think that's quite an encouraging position to be in.
And my question's related to residential transactions, because that is where there is a differential that I think is worth exploring. I just want to question something you said. I think you said the estimate was about returning to average volume of house sales. Was that correct? Because my concern about the data in your own forecasting methodology shows that forecast volume of sales is set to decline. While still remaining positive, which is good news, the assumption is from 5.43% this year to 1.25%, and that must have an impact on the forecast revenue that the government is assuming.
That's about a growth rate. And essentially what... I'm assuming that Jackie Bailey's seen the forecasting methodology paper, and what that shows is that how the government estimates by the growth that takes place over the next number of years, we end up in a position of where we return to the the average annual growth in volume of residential transactions. So the point that Jackie Bailey's focusing on, if I look at the table on page 9 of the forecasting methodology, Jackie Bailey's absolutely correct that there is a slowing up in the growth rate of transactions, but it's a slowing up of a growth rate that gets us to the average of residential transactions.
Can you tell me what the average is?
It's 6%.
And this will get us to that? Because yes. That's not evident from the table.
Well, on page 9 of the government's forecasting mm-hmm. methodology, in figure 1 and table 7, the detail is shown graphically in figure 1, and the detail is underpinned in table 7, and that's taken from Registers of Scotland and the Sessions Register.
I just think it's quite optimistic, given where we are, but that's interesting to have that response. Can I just follow up the behaviour?
Can I just say that I think, you know, if I go back to the point that I discussed with Mr. Mason a second ago, the Scottish Fiscal Commission has put the government through the ringer, if I could put it like that. So it's in a talking language that we all understand what I mean. We've been put through the ringer, and the Scottish Fiscal Commission has judged our forecasts to be reasonable. So I think...
With all due respect, also judged that they hadn't had an adequate response 2 years running to the additional request to model the behavioural response to LBTT. And when you consider the action plan that was presented late in the day, I think they, I don't want to say put words in their mouth, but the suggestion that they were quite annoyed that so little progress had been made on such an important item, well, I thought was evident from the dialogue we had with them last week.
I think if we look at the modelling paper that was put out by the government, you know, there's an extensive amount of detail on behavioural analysis that is here. Now, I'm not for a moment trying to suggest that this is the end of the story. I'm accepting that we must continue to refine our approach to behavioural analysis. And so I don't want in any way to suggest that we're not continuing to do that. But I do think we've got a reasonable amount here. The Fiscal Commissioner are quite right to say to us, you've got to do more, and I accept that, and we'll do more.
And I think there was a sense of urgency about it rather than something that's considered in the long term. So, you know, if you're reflecting that urgency, that's very welcome indeed. Can I move on to borrowing? Okay. You've committed in your budget to using the limit of your borrowing powers, which is £316 million in 16-17. I understand that the figure for this year was about £320 million, give or take. 304, there you go, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. None of that has yet been drawn down, and I'm not sure whether you've established the mechanism by which you would do so yet. Is that caught up in the fiscal framework discussions? Do you intend to draw it down? And if so, when and what you're likely to spend it on?
Well, let me take the questions in reverse order. What we spend it on will be our capital programme. Okay. Essentially, the borrowing facility is there to fund our capital programme. But the amount of borrowing we draw down will be dependent on the amount of funds we require to support capital projects within a year. So Jackie Bailey will understand that I will not borrow any money that I don't require to use. So, for example, if I had capital projects that were not going to require to be paid this year, there would be no sense in me borrowing the money. There would be no sense in me borrowing £304 million if I don't need to spend £304 million because, you know, the wet weather has slowed up a project, so we don't have that much money going out the door on a particular project, or whatever it happens to be. So the issues are not tied up in the fiscal framework,
okay.
None whatsoever. They are, the arrangements are in place. We will borrow at the cheapest rate, so whatever route we take will be the cheapest one in terms of repayments, and we will borrow the amount of money we require to support our plans between now and the end of the financial year. And I'll obviously update Parliament about what steps we take in that respect.
Okay. At what stage do you think you'll arrive at a conclusion, given we're into the budget process?
That is a very active issue on my agenda, and I'm looking at it on an almost daily basis.
Okay, so that's the government response would be soon.
Oh no, it's much. No, I know. I know what the government response of soon means. It's much earlier than that.
Oh, that's even better. Soonest. There we go. Can I explore a borrowing power you currently have for revenue? And I listened carefully to what you said because that power gives you the ability to borrow revenue up to 200 million in a given year, if your receipts are actually less than anticipated. Now, you're confident that in all areas your receipts are going to exceed expectations overall?
Yes, I am.
So you've no concerns about non-domestic rates or indeed LBTT residential element?
I can only use that resource borrowing facility for devolved taxes. Yep. I can't use it for a non-domestic rates.
Okay, that's fine. Can I move to non-domestic rates now? Because there's a forecast fall in revenue of 2.8% in real terms. That's obviously quite substantial. It's the first time, I think, it's been estimated for 16-17. I'm just curious to know, is that the influence of the Fiscal Commission saying your buoyancy estimates were too optimistic, or is there something else going on in there that's led to this?
There's two things that are affecting the non-domestic rates pool. First of all, it's the effect of inflation. Inflation is much lower than was predicted when we made our estimates of non-domestic rates. For example, the inflation forecast for 2015 reduced from 3.3% to 2.1%, and that has quite a substantial effect on the degree of non-domestic rates we could expect to come forward. So inflation has been a factor. Secondly, the buoyancy estimates, which, as Jackie Bailey will recall, the Fiscal Commission suggested were over-optimistic, so we reduced them. The buoyancy estimate for 2014-15 was 1.55%, and it actually translated as 0.82%, which has an effect on our estimates. So these factors, I would characterise it more as the effect of these factors rather than the estimation.
Okay, that's helpful to know. You've set a large business supplement at 2.6 pence, which is double my understanding of similar rate in the UK for similar-sized properties. Given, you know, that you've kept quite a close correlation between the UK and Scotland on income tax, on LBTT, on landfill tax, why differently on non-domestic rates? Can I add something to that? Because just to aid the understanding, I'm assuming you're collecting in totality the same amount, but actually you're placing the burden in different places. Would that be fair?
Roughly the same amount, yes. But what we're doing is, in some respects, there are similarities in the approach that we've taken with the rest of the United Kingdom, but in others, we've taken dramatically different approaches. We've taken a dramatically different approach on small business bonus, small business scheme support, for example, where our scheme has been significantly more generous than the rest of the United Kingdom. So, you know, we were on the more generous end of the spectrum in that respect. On this issue, I've faced difficult choices. I came to the conclusion that I would have to take steps to strengthen the volume of revenue raised by non-domestic rates, and I decided to apply a larger business supplement for the higher business supplement for the large business properties. What that translates into is a total increase in the rates bill for a company that's paying the large business supplement combined with their core business rate of 3.4% compared to the annual increase in 2015-16 of 2.3%. Now, if we look back over the last few years, in 2011-12, the increase in the rates bill for a company paying the large business supplement was 4.6%. and in 2012-13 it was 5.8%. So 3.4% set within that context, particularly where we've had pretty low levels of business rate increase because inflation has been reducing those increases. I think this is, you know, this is a not unreasonable charge that we're making.
I think businesses would maybe take a slightly different view,
sure.
You know, and I've certainly had a letter from ASDA indicating they would pay 2.6% higher in Scotland than in the rest of the UK. And I think the reference made by businesses is the commitment given by yourself and the First Minister to ensure that the rates regime is the same, both north and south of the border, because you would want to not create any disincentives, that you would want that to be kept in line with the rest of the UK. Genuine concerns from them about investment decisions that they'll make on the back of that.
And I understand those concerns, and I do understand them, and I don't in any way dismiss them. I just would say that our commitment has never been to have the same business rates regime as England because, of course, as I've explained already in the small business bonus scheme, we've had a significantly more generous scheme in place. So our commitment has been to maintain the uniform business rate, which we have maintained at 48.4 pence. But the large business supplement, I took a decision that it was possible to increase that to strengthen the non-domestic rates pool.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Mark, to be followed by Gavin.
Thank you, Convener. A lot of ground has been covered already, so I've only got a couple of questions. You mentioned, Cabinet Secretary, around the impact of forestalling and that forming part of the discussions that are taking place with Treasury ministers in relation to block grant adjustments. I wondered if the Treasury have given any indication of their numbers in terms of where they've seen the impact of forestalling. Particularly in their March figures. We've had some figures put before us which have shown a quite substantial forestalling in terms of £1 million plus properties in the March period, which I would imagine has led to quite a boon for the Treasury in that period as well. Has there been any indication from the Treasury around that?
Not from the Treasury. Obviously, the OBR forecast has increased, which I think is a sort of independent validation of all of these questions. The data on the data on the number of transactions. Let me just think. I must. The data on the number of transactions must be. It'll be available to us. I'm just looking at. In the Register of Scotland statistical release. For July to September, whether it goes down to the degree of detail in price bracket that Mr. MacDonald is asking about, I don't think it does in this publication, but I'm pretty sure Register of Scotland.
Be helpful, Councillor. The numbers we had put before us were from a Your Move ACCA data examination of house price of transactions, which indicated in terms of sales, there were in £1 million plus sales, they indicated 90 took place in March and none in April, according to the numbers they had.
I've accepted there was an impact of forestalling where transactions took place between January and March, and that will have had an effect on the market. I've made no attempt to avoid that point.
No, indeed. And merely I was asking whether the Treasury had given you a look at what data they had in terms of the impact on stamp duty land tax during that period, but that's helpful in that respect. Secondly, on the issue around SRIT and the ongoing budget discussions that are taking place, and I know that one of the things you've always said at budget time is that if other parties in the Parliament have alternative approaches or would wish to see something different being done, that your door is open to listening to that. And leaving aside the Deputy Convener on this, have you received any other opinions or views in terms of what you should be doing in relation to SRIT at this stage?
I think it's early days.
Okay. Finally, just in terms of wrapping up on the issue around forestalling and behavioural response, etc., of course, there is, of course, a contrast with the approach taken at Westminster on these issues, where the Chancellor stands at the dispatch box and says, I am announcing a change, and it is effective as of midnight, in a bid to prevent the kind of forestalling effect. Obviously, there's a different approach taken here, which I think is a legacy of the parliamentary approach to budget scrutiny, and something which I know you're very keen to ensure that you respect the views and wishes of Parliament in regards to that. But do you take a view in terms of going forward as we get more powers coming in over areas of taxation and the likelihood of behavioural response to pre-announcement of changes before they come into effect? Do you have a view as to whether there would be a more helpful approach that could be taken?
I think it raises some issues for Parliament to consider about how we organise ourselves in this respect, and you know, these are I'd happily engage in discussion with the committee about these points, because it does create the ability of the Chancellor to change stamp duty rates that night. Did create a difficulty for us, and we can see the effect of that. It's heading for around about £30 million worth of a problem for us. So it's quite it's a tangible issue. I think when I look at what I'm doing on the 3% supplement, that's requiring primary legislation, and that's we're going to have to move at some pace, as the committee may have noticed. He says delicately. We believe we require primary legislation to do this. The advantage we have here is that we're not at risk. If there's a forestalling issue, then we'll be the benefit. We'll get it, unless people in England decide to buy holiday homes in Scotland, or second homes, or buy to let properties in Scotland to avoid the George Osborne proposition in the window between January and March. And that somehow, and to avoid the 3%, and then potentially to avoid an LBTT charge here. So for a property that would attract an LBTT charge here, that may happen. But I don't think that's going to be of the £30 million variety. So I think there's an issue to be explored here about our processes as to whether or not we need to look at having a slightly more nimble process for changing some of these questions. Mm. But I stress that's a discussion I'm happy to engage in with the committee.
And following on from that, obviously, the Chancellor is not necessarily restricted in terms of when he brings in those changes, as we saw with the stamp duty change. He didn't have to announce it as part of a specific point in the calendar year. He didn't have to stand up and announce that. Is that, again, something you're reflecting on, or you think that Parliament itself should reflect on in terms of the flexibilities that exist within the parliamentary structures to allow for such an approach from a Scottish Government in the future, should it choose to make changes?
I think, notwithstanding the requirement for us in certain circumstances to respond promptly and swiftly to certain circumstances, I generally take the view that it's a good thing to do all these things as part of a budget process, to set it as I did in December, albeit late in the year, the whole picture of tax and revenue and expenditure, and to do it all in one go, and to allow Parliament to consider those issues.
Okay, thanks.
Do we follow by Jean?
Cabinet Secretary, you said in answer to Jackie Bailey that you thought in terms of devolved taxes for 15-16 that you would come in ahead of projections. If that happens, was the block grant adjustment for 15-16 without prejudice as well, and could that spark a review of that, or was that slightly different from 16-17? Was that absolutely fixed for that year?
My recollection is that was absolutely fixed.
Yeah. Right, okay, fixed. So there's no risk. Okay. But for 16-17 it is, to use this term you've used, without prejudice. I'm just wondering.
I think if I could just maybe say that, I think that's that is perhaps to do with the fact that we've had to arrive at a second year of a one-off block grant adjustment, which sure. I don't think anybody wanted to do, but it's because we haven't got the fiscal framework agreed. So I think they are in two different categories, and I'm not complaining about any part of it. It's where we are.
Okay. I suppose the reason I asked though is just that if you reach 16 million, if the OBR projection is something like 627 million. And your projection is 671 million. Is it not then almost certain that the 600 million, if the 600 million is a good bit below both of those estimates, are we not almost then certainly to have some kind of adjustment later?
We'll see.
Okay, right.
And as a father of numerous children, Mr. Brennan will know what "we'll see" means.
I suspect we could spend the rest of the day discussing that, and so in that case, I'll move on. Okay, I suspect we won't get much more clarity. In terms of income tax, my recollection could be wrong, I'm just going from the statement you gave to Parliament, which I haven't reread in advance of today. My recollection is that you set the 10 pence rate for 16-17, and I'm 50% sure you said the government will set out its medium-term intentions in the early part of the year. Now, obviously, there's an election coming up in May, and so it depends who is running the country after that. But is it your intention to set out the government's medium-term intentions for income tax over the next month or two?
I think what I'd like to get to the point in my statement where I could quote exactly what I said, but I'm going to struggle, I think, to find it without keeping the committee here long. But essentially, what I said was that subject to securing agreement around a fiscal framework, I would set out our medium-term approach to tax. I can confirm that. I hope that from 2017-18, this Parliament will have more flexibility in setting income tax rates. However, that will depend on reaching agreement on a new fiscal framework and final passage of the Scotland Bill. I can confirm that subject to achieving these outcomes, the Government will set out our longer-term intentions with regard to income tax ahead of the dissolution of Parliament at the end of March. So it's really, essentially it's making the simple point that we won't be able to set out our position if we don't have a fiscal framework, sure. because we'll not be having the Scotland Bill. But if we get the fiscal framework then agreed by the 12th of February, then I will set out my position to Parliament.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Right, non-domestic rates, we've talked about a little bit already. When I look at page 95 of the budget, non-domestic rates seem to go down, not just in real terms, but they appear to go down in cash terms by round about £30 million from 15-16 to 16-17. I'm assuming included in the figure for 16-17 is the £130 million or so yes. that you anticipate being collected. So like for like, they're down by £160 million potentially. So even with an increase in the poundage of 0.8%, taking you to 48.4, and the increase in the large business supplement up to 2.6 pence. Even with those increases, we're still down in cash terms by £30 million. Now, obviously, growth for the economy as a whole over that year is projected to increase. So I guess I'm at a loss to try and understand why are we going down in cash terms when we've increased the taxes and overall economic growth is still projected to be in the region of 2%.
I'm exploring the very same questions, because I think if I add also into that the pattern of non-residential LBTT transactions, mm-hmm. which are very, very encouraging, I'm fascinated. Well, I'm not fascinated. I'm determined to understand the relationship between all of these things, because I think the growth rate is, growth this morning, GDP growth this morning in quarter is 0.1%. We're 1.7% growth, annualised growth, which is a reasonably healthy growth. The UK is 2.1% by comparison. So there is growth in the economy. Non-residential transactions are performing very well, much better than we anticipated. What I don't know is if they're performing better because we had our estimate wasn't good, or wasn't well, you know, wasn't as effectively informed by data as our as it might have been, or whether the economy is doing well. Some of the analysis I look at about availability of property is looking tight again in certain parts of the country. So there are a whole variety of factors which then make the non-domestic rates position look a little bit out of kilter. So I'm exploring that issue. It's a reasonable issue that Mr. Brown raises.
Okay, fine. Come down, and maybe you don't have a full answer to this then, but for the 15-16 figure, which is most of the way through the year, are we on track for the 15-16 figure for non-domestic rates, or has 15-16 then been a little bit optimistic and there's an adjustment into 16-17, or as far as you're aware, are we on track?
Well, we'll take some effect in 15-16 because of the reduction in inflation. So some of those factors will begin to play in, and some of the effect of buoyancy will begin to play in as well. So some of those factors will be apparent in 15-16 as well.
Okay.
And that will affect the non-domestic rates pool.
So as far as you're aware, I mean, do you think we're slightly behind schedule then on for 15-16, or is it too difficult to say?
I think it's a bit too... I think it's difficult to be precise about that, but we will have a better idea as the remainder of the year goes on.
Okay. Large business supplement, you've had a couple of questions on that already. Has there been a business and regulatory impact assessment carried out for that? And
no.
If not, will there be one carried out for it?
We're at consultation now on these questions, and it's in that context that I will look at the issues that are relevant to a business regulatory impact assessment.
Okay, thank you. All right, land and buildings transaction tax. I want to focus on the residential aspect of it. Okay, you've had various comments about the behavioural impact, and there does appear to be a bit of a disagreement. But given that you said at the start of proceedings here to the convener, words to the effect of that you believed as a general proposition, it's extremely important to look at the behavioural impact, and it's something you need to work on year by year. Okay, that was your general proposition. For the LBT supplementary charge, you appear to have put those words into practice, and you appear to have done, I think, a pretty high degree of work in terms of trying to work out the behavioural impact. The bit where I'm then lost is the Fiscal Commission saying that in their concluding remarks, and they reiterated it again here last week, page 37 of their report, paragraph 8.3. Now, last year they recommended behavioural response be looked at for LBTT. Now they're using the expression, in particular, we are increasingly concerned about the residential LBTT forecast, which still assume no behavioural responses. Now, they've expressed it pretty strongly, I think, over the piece. They've used the term increasingly concerned here. What will it take from them for you to actually look at a behavioural response on residential LBTT?
Well, that work is being undertaken now in the light of the Fiscal Commission's recommendations.
So it will have
an effect on any forward projections that we arrive at, obviously, which will have to be tested by the Fiscal Commission.
Sure. Okay. And last question then, or last area, just again on LBTT, and again it's raised by the Fiscal Commission. You've set out, I think helpfully, I have to say, your projections over the period instead of just doing single year projections. When we get to £545 million worth of residential LBTT, according to the Fiscal Commission, your assumption is that out of the £545 million, £188 million worth of it will come from fiscal drag, and they raise some questions about how viable that is. Is it your position, and again this is a medium to long term thing depending upon the outcome of the election, is it the government's intention that there are no changes to the thresholds at all over that 5-year period?
In the forecast that we have published, the answer to that question is there are no changes to the assumptions. So this is a a rolling forward of the existing policy position on LBTT. I of course must reserve the government's position if the government is fortunate enough to be re-elected to change these provisions if it decides to do so. But there is no, I wouldn't want the committee to read into these estimates that these are definitive predictions. These are a prediction in 2020, to take that as an example, of the application of the current policy framework and the variables that will get us to that point. And I discussed with Jackie Bailey some of the issues around number of transactions, assumptions about price. Mr. Choate discussed some of those issues with the committee into the bargain. But you know, this is where I think we've got to be careful about the five-year forecasts. You know, the five-year forecasts are just a setting out of what would happen if we didn't change anything. We may well change things. That'll be for the government to decide in due course. But crucially, we're setting out a proposition here for 16-17 that underpins a proportion of the budget. So that one is really critical in setting that out.
Okay, I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Jean.
Thank you. First of all, a kind of observation, really. I also, as I'm sure everybody did, received a letter from ASDA about the large business supplement. And just really the observation is that, you know, before the Scottish Parliament existed, the differential between rates and rateable value in Scotland and England was dramatic, and again, not in Scotland's favour. I mean, it was only when the price per pound was the poundage was adjusted, I think, by yourself, that we actually started to see our rates become anywhere close to being equal with England. So just, I think it's worth noting that the ASDAs of this world and others actually are only beginning to see a comparable with rates comparable with England, non-domestic rates comparable with England.
I think in the interest of fairness and accuracy, the previous government, the Scottish Executive, took steps in its latter days, and I think it probably happened in 2005-06. Or 6-7?
I think it might have been 6-7.
6-7 took steps to get to a position where it was the same pound. What was previous? Jean Urquhart is right in absolutely in this point, that for many years the poundage rate in Scotland was higher than the poundage rate in England, and they were equalised, I think, in about 2006-7, and obviously the government has sustained that since then.
To be fair, okay. I'm very happy to be fair, Cabinet Secretary. What I wanted to ask really was about the kind of timelines. You did say at the beginning of this meeting that the Scottish Parliament must be satisfied with the fiscal framework and that there would be opportunity for scrutiny. Given that the Parliament will cease to be on the 20-something of March, and that you're hoping to reach agreement with something you can come and present to Parliament on the 12th of February. Are we going to see that complete? Are you hoping to see that complete, that scrutiny work, and inviting a Scottish Parliament to approve this agreement before the Scottish election?
What we've said, and I've been clear about this to Parliament and to the United Kingdom government, is that we will not put a legislative consent motion on the Scotland Bill to Parliament unless we have a fiscal framework that we can recommend to Parliament. Now, I appreciate, and so therefore, and the timetable dictates that we have to have that fiscal framework agreement in place for us to lodge a motion on the acceptable parliamentary timetable for legislative consent by the 12th of February. Now, if we get to that point, I will be recommending a fiscal framework to Parliament that I have negotiated, and I'm going into that negotiation in good faith to secure an agreement that implements what was required of us by the Smith Commission. And there is a possibility that I will not be able to get such an agreement that satisfies me, that's consistent with the Smith Commission. So I won't be coming to Parliament with such a recommendation because I'm unable to get such an agreement. Now, I hope not to be in that position because I want us to be able to exercise the powers under the Smith Commission. But that's how the sequence of events work. Now, I accept that the committee is not able to see an early draft of it, a mid-draft, a late draft, or any draft, because there isn't such a draft because we don't have an agreement yet, and that's been worked through to get to that point. But I will only come to Parliament with a legislative consent motion if I'm satisfied in the detail of the fiscal framework that we have before us.
And this may just be my own ignorance of procedures, but there would be no... This wouldn't be a situation where there's consultation, public consultation at
no.
all.
No,
so the.
But I think what. I think
what scrutiny would there be? What opportunity would there be? I mean, there are a number of economists you'll know who are very anxious about
it. I think the issues about the fiscal framework have been pretty well aired in wider media, and indeed the committee has taken evidence from a range of different experts on this question, and. I think those issues are out there, and the way I'm looking at this, and I appreciate this is not ideal, but I've tried throughout this. I've taken part in parliamentary debates, I've taken part in the committee's inquiries, I've appeared here on a number of occasions to give evidence. I've tried to inform the discussion as much as I can about the issues that are at stake, but what I can't tell the committee today is the detail of the agreement, because it's not agreed. Not because I'm keeping it to myself. It's not agreed. And so, but we know, I'm clear in my mind what has to be in that agreement, because the Smith Commission essentially set it out. And if that's not what's in the agreement, then the legislative consent motion will not be coming to Parliament.
Okay, thank you.
That appears to have concluded questions from the committee. I've just got one or two questions to follow up. On non-domestic rates, I mean, what is the buoyancy rate for 2016-17, and how does that compare with 15-16?
0.97 is the rate for 16-17, and if you give me one second, convener, the buoyancy rate for 15-16 is 1.25.
Okay, thank you very much. And just a follow-up to a question that Mark asked, basically. You talked about Treasury's not having discussion with the Treasury regarding forestalling. Was that not part of the discussions in terms of block grant adjustment?
No, I think it was. I think the question that Mr. McDonald asked me was about if I had discussions about the number of £1 million properties.
Right, apologies.
We've talked about forestalling.
Yeah. It was about the impact that forestalling had had in terms of the Treasury's revenues, if they'd given any indication as to what they'd seen from their own revenues, but I think the Cabinet Secretary indicated that wasn't the case.
Thanks. And just on a point about SRIT, whether it's regressive or not. clearly, the STC have said it is regressive. The reason for that is basically because they've said that if taxes go basic rate from 20 to 22 pence, that's a marginal rate of 10%, whereas for higher taxpayers, for 45 to 47, that's a marginal rate of 4.4%. So that's, I think, one of the reasons why they said it's regressive in terms of their evidence.
But that's
is that not the case?
Those factors are absolutely correct, convener. But I think I can't deny that the Scottish rate of income tax, as it currently stands, is progressive. You have to be careful in the decisions that you take that you maintain that progressivity.
Okay. On that point, is there anything further you would wish to add before we wind up the session?
Only to say, convener, that I do look forward to meeting with the committee in my own constituency on Monday, which, and I'm profoundly grateful to the. committee yes. for enabling me to welcome you to Pitlochry.
Well, as you know, it is a key margin, and we're trying to do all we can to assist you with the election, only a few months away. Thank you. I'd like, therefore, to wind up the session for today. Thank everyone for their questions and contributions.